Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for hopping in. Matt, what time is it over there, man?
It's 1 o'clock in the morning, Western Australian time.
I really appreciate you staying up late with me. Fine, it's freaking awesome, man. It's 9 a.m. here in California, and it's 1 a.m. in Perth. And we have come together to do this stream for y'all. It's going to be a very chill stream. I got to give a shout out to my man, Adam Feverkin, who put that custom music together for your awesome visuals. All that was from your various games, your various experiences that you've put together. And there's a link to your website in the description down below where people can hop in and play those games and explore those environments. Do you want to tell me a little bit about why and how you got into making those things, Matt?
Yeah, so I guess talk about what you'll be downloading first. It's essentially like I make naturally inspired Unreal Engine environments, and I'm currently in the process of putting together a video game, which is a compilation of all the environments, which you'll be able to download, and essentially a photography simulator. So you can walk around at your own pace, just like take a bunch of photos, and just sort of like absorb in the atmosphere, I guess. Yeah.
It's such a cool idea, man. I love this idea so much. It's like, I feel we're so aligned on just like the atmospheric music and the imagery, man. I love what you do much. Man. It's so good. And it's very unique. Like I've never really seen a video game like this where you just kind of walk around and take pictures. You know, of course there's Pokemon Snap, but this is very different. And like there are games like Flow or Journey, and like those games are art pieces. But there's definitely game elements to it. This is like very relaxing, where you walk around with a camera and take really cool shots of the environment, and you put these environments together in such a cool way. I'm very excited to jump in with you and like figure out how we're going to make this, how you make these. So
yeah, I'm so excited as well, man. Thanks everyone for having me, by the way. Like, it's great to be here. I've never done a stream before, so it's awesome to see like everyone in the chat. Yeah, this is great.
Yeah, man, it's gonna be a blast. I feel like having guests on is the way to do this. Like hanging out with someone who you admire and creating art with them, that's the way to go, and sharing off all their art is so cool. Hunter, I see you. Thank you for that super chat. Much appreciated, brother. Very good stuff. Yes, it's good to be back. It's good to be back. Yeah, it's 1 a.m. where Matt is. It's 9 a.m. where I am. We're coming together.
Someone says I look tired. I'm not too bad, honestly. I've been preparing for this, so it's fine. It's all good.
Yeah, so hey, what are we gonna do today? What are we gonna do? What's the goal?
So I had this idea. I've been watching a bunch of YouTube videos from a YouTuber called Craig Adams recently. And the styles of videos that he does like silent hiking films, if that's a way to describe it. He does like long, like 15-minute compilations of an entire hike where the video is essentially just footage of him walking with the sounds of like his footsteps and nature.
Hey, and if you pull it up, I can switch over to your display if you're ready.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I can get up the video.
Yeah. It's on you now. So yeah.
Cool. So I'll just play this in the background, I suppose. So he just does like atmospheric like shots of him walking through like amazing landscapes. I personally have relied on his videos a lot to like put in the background while I'm working. I find it's like a great thing to have watching inspiration. Yeah, so he just like captures all the great details, and I thought that this would just make like an awesome like base for like a project. Like some of these environments have like such great detail, and there's this one part in the video like a couple minutes in.
What's up, William?
And there's like this awesome like red sun coming through. I saw that scene. I was like, oh, damn, I'd love to make a scene out of that. So
beautiful.
Yeah, we'll see what we can achieve on this stream. hopefully it's not too ambitious. We've only got like a few hours, but yeah, I'm so excited.
Yeah, so basically we're going to create a small environment, very much like Matt has created for his games, but these are obviously to a much larger scale. We're going to bake down, we're going to boil down your skill, Matt, and we're going to apply it to a very small scene that you're going to help guide me through, and the audience as well. Unreal Engine is free, and y'all can hop in and learn with us for free if you have Unreal Engine. I think we're in version 4.27 we're going to be in here. And we want, by the end of this stream, we want to have a downloadable exe file that you can play and hop into and like explore this environment that we're going to create right now for yourself. So that's pretty sweet.
I mean, that's the goal. Yeah, that's the goal. Obviously, yeah, with Australian internet, I don't know how far we'll get with like uploading the build and everything, but the aim is to have, yeah, playable exe file, downloadable. You can like walk around, just look at everything. Yeah, we'll see. We'll see how far we get.
Sweet, sweet.
I just saw Will Fauché in the chat.
Yeah, what's up,
great
dude?
To see you, man. I love his tutorials. I've learned so much from you, man.
Yeah, he's the one. He's freaking so great, so nice. He was on last month. We did a live stream together, and that dude is the best.
Yeah, I watched through. That was great.
Shout outs to my boy Devon Williams holding it down in Georgia. Good to see you, dude. Well, I'm not seeing you, but it's nice. I sense your presence. That's the important thing. So where do we begin, man? Let's switch over here. Let's open up Unreal Engine.
Yeah, I can tell people a bit about who I am. People have no idea.
I'm getting ahead of myself. Thanks for hitting the brakes on that. Who are you?
Just because.
What do you do?
I don't upload YouTube videos. Like, I'm not. Yeah, I've wondered. Like, who is this guy? I'm from Perth, West Australia. I am currently still an engineering student. Regretfully, I really wish I could by now. But I picked up Unreal while I was studying, and that sort of stemmed from me doing a bunch of photography back when I was in high school, and that continued. I used to love taking photos while I was traveling. I sort of built up a knowledge of like color correction, and like I did a little bit of videography, but not too much. And I was at a point where I really felt, like I could dive into something that I can sink my teeth into. You know, like photography is great and all, but I really felt like there was more I could do. I wanted to like move the mountains, move the sun, and have more like customizability about what I was creating. So this was about 3 years ago. It was the beginning of 2018. I started diving into Unreal, and since then I've just been like, it's a matter of like Googling every single problem you have on the Unreal Answer Hub. That's how you get there.
Yeah, it's a lot of troubleshooting. Constant troubleshooting.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a huge program. There's so much stuff, man. It blows me away. I began to make scenes that were inspired by, you know, the places I've been, the photos I've taken. I always found that photos are the best like point of reference. If you're making a photorealistic environment, it's great to like look at the way light interacts with things, and as well as realism, you also want to put like your own flair on things, you know, like with colors and atmosphere. So yeah, that's sort of how I got to here. Unreal sort of has a lot of facets in like lots of industries. I've been very lucky to be in this spot, as lots of people have sort of converged on Unreal.
Yeah.
Because there's so many applications for it. Like, it started out as a game engine, and it's really fleshed out in those aspects. But yeah, like I figured, you know, it has a lot of what I needed. And then through making environments, I've been able to like to work in like bits of films. I've done like live visuals and done a little bit of game development. All sorts of stuff.
I think it's really cool that you are a photographer first, and you base a lot of your 3D art on the places you've been. I don't really know of anyone else who does that kind of thing, because that's, I love traveling. I think we're both very similar in that we love to travel, and we both love Japan very much. And going to these places where you don't feel like you actually feel like you're exploring a new place. That's why traveling is the best. You meet new people, you discover new places, and you get lost in a place that you've never been before. And sometimes when you go out into the mountains, into nature without your phone, and you have a camera and you have some ambient music and you're out there just enjoying nature, that's so inspiring. It's so inspiring. And it's funny because, like, we have this instinct to capture that, bring it back to our house, and be like, man, I just want to be in that as much as possible. Let's create an environment based off of where I was. It's so funny, but, yeah, like, it gets absolutely me so excited. It's the best.
Yeah, I mean, even back from, like, I used to watch Corridor quite a lot, and I, like, immediately recognize that from your work. Like, you put out some amazing renders, like,
oh, thanks, man.
I automatically, like, connected with that. I particularly loved, like, I loved the render you did of the car next to the docks. That's my favorite one of yours.
I appreciate it, man. That was based off a trip that I took with Adam, the Feverkin, the guy who did the music at the intro here, who you know of. It's cool that all three of us are connected in, like, one spot now on the stream. That's awesome. But yeah, it was a trip with Adam, and, like, I've never been to such an intense place before. And I just wanted to capture that as much as possible. I wanted to, like, distill it down to a video, you know, an experience. So
yeah, it's amazing, man. Like, when I saw that, I was like, oh, Clint has, like, the perfect idea of, like, what I'm about. So
heck yeah, dude. That's amazing. I'm really amped to dive in with you and, like, see what we can create. I feel like we could just do this for hours and hours and hours and hours. And
that's true.
Listen,
yeah, there are always tons of details to look at.
Before we hop in,
maybe clock's ticking. Maybe we should get started. Oh yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, we should get started. I just want to give a shout out to One Dead Duck for the super chat. I really appreciate you. Everybody who's hopping in. I know I've been streaming less these days to take some time for myself, and it's been great. It's been fantastic. So I really appreciate everyone who's hopping in here and learning with us today. So let's do it. Let's hop in, shall we?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right.
Yeah, thanks to Shannon, Hunter, Wolf O'Shea, Blender Boulder. Yeah, good to see everyone. Sorry. I just love having, like, a live reaction to all this. This is awesome.
Oh, you don't have to apologize for that, dude. Absolutely. People are holding it down. Yeah. Okay. So, do you want to describe to us what we're in here? Like, what's going on in this scene? Can anyone get this scene, or is this, like, what's going on here?
So I just set up, like, a template project for us to work with. I was tempted to go from nothing, but obviously, time is against us. I just thought, like, it's great to put in some trees and whatnot, because we'll be relying on mega scans for a lot of stuff we include, but mega scans doesn't have any trees at the time of this live stream, which I think it's actually planned, or I've heard rumors or announced some sort of announcement. Trees might be in mega scans at some point in the future, but until then, yeah, it'll be us. Like, we'll be importing a whole bunch of surface textures for the landscape. We'll be importing a lot of meshes that we can lay out over the ground, and when we import these meshes, we'll be using a bunch of our custom-made master materials that I've already imported into the project. So my project's looking a bit more complicated than Clint's, maybe, but that's because I imported the first-person blueprint that I'm working with. This first-person blueprint is, like, essentially the game format that I use for my project. So you have, like, a camera that you can use and walk around with. So I included this because at the very end of the game, I'll be able to just put that in the scene and then hopefully click compile, and then we'll have an EXP that's playable. So I thought it was best that I figured that stuff out beforehand.
Smart. Yeah.
But yeah, aside from that, so where to jump in? I've got a list that we can start off with. So I was just going to like make a start on the landscape. I'm going to be importing some materials from Megascans. So just to...
Jose, thank you for the super chat. Appreciate you very much. Thanks for hanging out with us. So you're building, what's your plan here? You said you want to go and create that like sunset tree scene from the video.
Yeah, that's the goal. So yeah, I watched a bunch of the scenes from the video and I tried to like gauge what the ground looks like, what kinds of like assets we'll use to put this together. I browsed Megascans for a while, just like searching some key terms that I thought would help, like, you know, mossy rocks and low surfaces. So I'm not sure what my screen's showing right now, but we got we got some like varied surfaces. I picked like a couple of different types of snow and ground textures. I think I'll be starting with these surface textures here, which I won't use the Megascans plugin for. I'll just import those manually. Just because the Megascans plugin creates materials automatically, but we actually have a master material that I've made that I want to use instead. So I guess, Clint, if you're following along, we can
go into
like the masters folder.
All right, let's see here. Okay.
In landscape masters, we'll want to create a material instance from the landscape template master material.
Got you. So that's a right click right at the top, create material instance. Sweet.
And I'm going to go into my Megascans folder that's saved on my computer and just like drag those textures in.
Into where?
So just into the content browser.
Oh, got you. I've never done it this way, actually.
Really?
Yeah, I've never done it this way. That's good
to know. So for now, we're going to want our albedo, our displacement, and our normal maps.
Oh, I see. You're talking about the actual textures, the images.
Yeah, so in Megascans, there's like a function you can click go to files and it opens up the file location for you.
Perfect. So this is for your ground plane, right? We're building up a ground plane.
Essentially, yeah. So the way landscape materials work is you can choose a couple of different surfaces that you like to blend between. Because I've imported my landscape master material already, most of the hard work's been done for us. We can just import our textures into the project and then fit those into our material instance that we've made. I guess to show off the landscape template that I've made, which is here.
Goodness.
We've got like a... I mean, it looks clear to me, but I guess that's because I've built it.
Yeah, what's the simplest form of this? Looks like you have a few duplicated things, right?
Yeah, so all of these are different material instances, and they all blend using this node, which is going to be a height blend. So we'll be referencing all the albedos and normal maps here. And then in the middle, we've just got a bunch of like parameters we can adjust, things like brightness, color, tint, desaturation.
Got you.
And they all come into this node here. Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how much material design you've done, Clint, but I guess I'll just try and stay as clear as possible with what I've done here in notebooks.
So you're basically combining a number of materials on the left, right? If you can go back to that material view. So you're combining a bunch together into that like middle node, right? What is that node in the middle that they're all going into? What is that called?
This is a layer blend.
Layer blend, got you. Okay, and then on the right, what's going on the right?
And here we've just got, I guess these are sort of like hacky kind of workarounds that I've done. So I've sort of split the material attributes here, which is just means I can do sort of last minute modifications. Like here, I've got like a texture overlay, which helps like vary the brightness of in the distance. And then down here, we've got got contact shadows. We've got material contact shadows. These are actually really, really cool. I'd love to talk about these a little bit more a bit later. But you should be able to you should be able to open the same material on your end, right?
Yeah, I just need to choose what material I want for the ground.
Cool.
And yeah, but
I guess because yeah, I favorited my material, so I know what I'm putting in already.
That's good. That's good. Do you want to maybe like link those up while I figure out what ground plane I'm going to use?
Yeah, sounds good. Right. I mean, I'm interested to see. Like, I'm sort of happy that you'll be choosing a bunch of different surfaces and assets. So we'll see. Like, it'll be interesting what you come up with.
Yeah, I might try and go for like a snowy scene to have something a little different. But yeah,
I remember we were looking at that one shot, like with Craig walking through like some foggy sections. I reckon that'd be sweet.
Yeah, agreed. And hey, William, I really appreciate you answering questions here in the chat. That's really nice of you, man. One of the questions here, Hunter is asking, is there a way to collaborate in Unreal Engine? And William mentioned Omniverse, which is a possibility. But Hunter's basically asking, like, are we working on the same file or two separate files? This is two separate files now. But yeah, how would you collaborate on one file in Unreal Engine?
I've only worked on my own projects. I haven't worked collaboratively on a game or anything like that. Mm-hmm. But I'm aware that collaboration is a whole thing. There's like version control and everything implemented through GitHub. You can set up a project and people can download branches and everything. It's a whole thing. I just haven't delved in too far into it.
Yeah.
Just because.
Same. But it'd be nice for these streams, actually. It'd be pretty sweet to, like, do some collaborative
work. That's true. Yeah, thinking about it now, like, if we're working on a similar project in the future, yeah, it'd work really well.
Also, shout-outs to Khalifa for the super chat. Much appreciated. Thanks for hanging out with us and chilling. And William, again, I really appreciate you answering those questions in the chat, man. That's super, super nice of you. Very, very cool. It's quite a treat to have you in there as well, man. So, okay, I need to figure out what the heck I'm going to do. Like, what? I need to figure out what my ground plane's going to be. I'm going to start downloading a bunch of snow assets and bringing those in. If you want to start downloading your ground, and like maybe once you get things set up, we can talk about how they're set up. Does that sound good?
Yeah, no problem. I'm just chucking in a couple of textures right now.
Okay, sounds good.
Yeah, and I guess once I've got things set up, I'll walk you through it so we can.
Oh, we got Casey up in here. Snap, Casey Edwards, very talented composer. He is the go-to. He is the man. Composer Casey, what's going on? We used to live together. Saying we used to live together sounds like it was so long ago. I felt like it's only like a year ago. What up, Casey? Good to see you, dude. Oh man, Boards of Canada. Oh, I wish you don't have to put that on yourself. I wish I could do that right now. I do want to figure out a way to like add music to these streams because it would elevate the vibe. The right music would elevate the vibe, no doubt. All right, I'm just downloading.
Yeah, forgive me for not. Yeah, all good. Forgive me for not looking at the chat too much. I'm really concentrating on this deadline. I really want to see if I can get something together.
Let's do it. Yeah.
But I guess I also don't want to like go blazingly fast or everything, so no one can pick up on anything that I did. So.
No, we'll go back and we'll touch on things that need to be touched on.
Yeah, cool. If there's anything I like glaze over or there was a chat question that that highlighted something, please let me know.
Sounds good. Well, I gotta update my plugins.
I'm ready for, I guess I can explain what I'm doing. I'm ready for like my next step. I'm importing my textures.
Yeah, go for it.
Cool. So I've got my landscape material instance here, so I'm just gonna, the way I've got it set up is that each texture is like a parameter, so I can just like feed in What I've got, I've chosen for variation, I've chosen two snow textures, one ground texture and one leaves texture. I actually might have forgotten leaves texture. So I'll give 1 second.
So your master material, you're saying that this instance, which we're using to populate to a bunch of different pieces of geometry, you wouldn't drop the instance on things. So,
yeah, the reason we use an instance is just so we can like manipulate the different parameters of the material on the fly. Like if you want to adjust like brightness, color, anything to do with that, if you have an instance, the effect will be immediate on the landscape. Instead of having to, like, if you just did it within the material, you'd have to like compile and wait for it to compile.
Yeah, and that's very, that's like very different, because in Cinema 4D or Blender, like, you don't really do that. And I was like, why would I need to create two of the same material here? This doesn't make any sense. But yeah, basically you have a master material, which is the full material built out. And then you have the instance, which is the one that is easily duplicated throughout all the different geometry in your scene. So it just keeps things running a lot faster.
Yeah, pretty much. I don't actually have any much, I don't have much experience with other renderers. Like Unreal is sort of the only thing that I know. So,
that's awesome.
I'll have to like at some point I'll have to dive into like another render and see how everything is handled. Just out of curiosity. Like I was meaning to pick up Blender a bit more seriously, but
I think Blender and Unreal Engine is a great combination together. Like,
oh, absolutely.
They're both free. Right. And like you can't really model in Unreal Engine. Like Unreal Engine to me, at least for my purposes, I'm using it to bring assets together and to build out environments in real time. And of course you can like gamify it, you know, which is what you have done. You turn it into a video game. For me, I'm here for like the photoreal real time environments for storytelling and for, you know, for like narrative scenes essentially for VFX. But it has so many uses, and that's why this program is so darn confusing at times, is because it was originally made for games, but people are using, like now it's kind of starting to be marketed as like, oh, you can actually do this for VFX and like production too. And there's so many layers to this program that I don't use because I'm not making games. But Matt, you are tapped in to the game side of things, as well as William too. You know, William was in that as well. But both of you guys are like very attuned to this entire program, and this is your jam. So I'm very excited to be learning from you and to be doing this with you, man. This is super cool. I'm such a noob.
Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I guess William, he sounds like much more of a veteran. Like he said he was around like during the Unreal Engine 3 days, like the source development kit and stuff like that. Like I've gone through a couple of forums, but like that's about it. Like he definitely knows much more in that sense. But you know, like I've been thinking about it a bit, like would it be a good thing for Unreal to split into like a cinematic renderer and a game development tool? And it's an interesting conversation. But I think like the more I've thought about it, I actually rely on a lot of game tools for the rendering stuff that I do. Like through the game development integration, I can like do so many complicated things that would have taken me ages to do in a traditional renderer. Like I put out a scene recently, which is essentially like it's a bit hard to explain, but all the instances on the landscape sort of like fly up into the air sort of harmoniously.
Yeah, let me pull that up real quick. Let me
oh,
I can do that.
If you want to.
Let me think really hard for a second. where is that? Here we go. That's funny. This video is Adam sent this to me, and this is titled Caves Reel for Pwnisher, bro.
Oh yeah, I saw that.
Okay, here we go. Let me switch over. So yeah, this like exploded out view. I was wondering, how the heck did you do this?
Yeah, like I was going to say, like, so traditionally that kind of stuff would take, I mean, I would assume it would take like keyframes, animations and things like that. Like you'd have to keyframe a lot of stuff. But considering it's a game development engine, you can just have a material that references a single value and then make that value unanimous among all instances. So the value would be respective of, okay, here's the center point and how far away from the center point is this instance. So you'd have that, and then you'd essentially have just like a sweeping effect from 0 to 1, and then it would just bring in, like, it would make all of the assets sweep up into the air. I was quite happy with that when I put that together, because
yeah, dude, it's awesome.
Obviously the scene took quite a long time to make, and so just doing like a quick render with like a cool effect, I don't know, it was lots of fun. It was really good.
Well, it really like lets you see, one, how many things are going into this, how many little assets and how many pieces are either hand placed, or actually, that's a great question. Do you hand place all your stuff? Like, how much of it is scattered around randomly? Well, not randomly, but like, you know, automatically, you know, scattered versus hand placed.
When I first started, I definitely like did a whole bunch of individual instancing, like using the foliage tool, just like placing things here and there.
Yeah.
And yeah, that was super time consuming. So yeah, more recently, like the last few years, I've been delving into like procedural foliage tools and things like that.
Yeah.
Which can be really useful. I've sort of found that the best outcome is to have like a combination of the two, where you're like instead of starting with a blank slate, you start with a completely procedurally generated like forest, for example. And then instead of building from nothing, you're like starting with a forest and then building back on things that you don't like and then adding detail to parts where you need it.
Mm.
I found that that's so much faster than, yeah, placing instances from scratch and like, yeah, doing all of that.
Like what we're doing right now, essentially.
Kind of, yeah. I'm still, sorry, I'm going so slowly, by the way.
It's okay.
Yeah, I'm just putting my...
It's all good.
I have no like ability to like work and talk at the same time.
But here, why don't you get it? I'll take over. I'll talk them through my process here, which is just me grabbing assets and bringing them in, which was really difficult to figure out at like the very beginning of things. So basically, you download Unreal Engine, okay? You're like, how do I even download Unreal Engine? That was the first thing I asked. And then you got to get the like Epic Games Launcher. It's like, no, I want to download Unreal Engine. But that's how you do it. You got to download the Epic Games Launcher. And in the Epic Games Launcher, you know, it brings up this whole thing right here. And basically, you're going to hit this Unreal Engine tab on the left, and you're going to go to Library, and you're going to download different versions of the program. And we're in 4.27 right now. People are all hyped up on Unreal 5. So that's how you, and you launch it, and you jump in, and then you're presented with the program. And you're like, okay, well, how do I make stuff look good? Where do I go from there? Well, getting the Megascans plugin is probably the next thing you want to do. This comes pre-installed in Unreal 5, and you can browse the marketplace for all of these free assets. It's like, it's ridiculous how all this stuff is free. It's not fair. Like, it's ridiculous. I'm going to just download this real quick because that looks cool. But I believe, boy, it's been a minute since I've done this, but once you download Bridge, you're essentially going to manage plugins, perhaps. You want to make sure that you have your Unreal Engine plugin installed here, and when you export things, there's a little cog on the bottom right, which you all can barely see. You got download and export settings, and you want to make sure it's going to Unreal Engine. Make sure the plugin's downloaded. And it might need to be enabled here by going to settings, plugins perhaps. And if I search for Megascans, it is enabled. Yeah, and you'll need to restart. And then what you can do is start downloading stuff and exporting. You'll see in the top right, export successful. And back in Unreal, you're going to get a little loading bar. And it's going to just work its way over across the internet all the way into your scene. This doesn't matter. And snowy embankment. Let's see. Bam, here we go. Right? And then you have your scene, which you drop in. And I'm navigating through this program by holding right click and using WASD, just like you were playing a first person shooter or something. And orbiting around the scene. And spacebar actually cycles between the different navigational tools. So I'm just hitting spacebar to move this stuff around. I don't know what I'm going to build yet. I don't know what scene I'm going to. I mean, obviously I'm doing a snowy scene here. I just don't know my composition. I don't know the layout of my stuff. I think what I'm doing right now is just gathering assets. I'm gathering as many assets that I'm going to use to build out my scene. Essentially my Legos. I'm getting all my Lego pieces ready. Everything is laid out in the world outliner. So if I were to clean this up, I can select all my geometry, and in the top right here, there's a little folder. We can click that and just type geometry. Boom. And I like to make another one for light, so I have my skylight, and let's see, exponential height fog, directional light. I'm just going to put that in a folder called light. And this blank template here, this was actually, Matt sent this over to me so that we can be sped up and working quickly on the stream. But when you hop in, you might start with a blank template. You'll have a menu. And in that menu, you're going to see like, do I want to start with a blank template? Do I want to start with, a first person shooter template? And you can choose between game or television and production, right? And you essentially, each one of those templates toggles certain plugins on and off for what you're specifically using it for. So I usually go with the like film and TV template. You can do a blank one or time of day template just to get you a sun and some atmosphere and whatnot in your scene already. So I'm just dropping stuff in here and trying to build out my Lego pieces.
Yeah, how's everything going? You need me to give you a hand with your landscape? Autosave hits just at the perfect moment every time.
I'm just downloading. I'm like gathering assets right now. So I'm still, I'm honestly kind of like trying to avoid the material setup. Maybe I should just rip off that band-aid and like jump in with it. I'm like, oh shoot, that looks advanced. But let me download a couple more of these embankments. How are you feeling? You feeling like you can talk about some stuff right now, or
yeah, I wanted to mention like with the whole design of the scene, like usually you would make a composition with your environment and like frame everything up nicely, get everything looking perfect. But with what I wanted to make on the stream, I guess you'd sort of take a different approach. Like this is how I usually approach my landscapes, is I just make a huge sort of half randomly generated environment with a lot of like sporadic placements for trees, like twigs, everything. And then the final renders sort of come from, you know, like random angles that I found in the environment. So once you put a whole bunch of random stuff together, I found sort of in the same vein of real world videography and photography, you have an environment that exists already and you just go around and like find angles. And obviously for some projects, like that's not the right way to go about things. Obviously you need like a really specific look, specific composition. But I found that, you know, in some aspects it really does help. Like if you make a composition from something that's somewhat randomly generated, it just creates a lot of like nice, I don't know how to say it, like
opportunities to discover interesting angles on the fly, right?
Yeah, it's sort of like something that's more naturally inspired, I suppose. Like if you're taking shows of the landscape, trees are never placed perfectly anywhere. Like like people who do landscape nature photography have to like make their own angles, and nothing is ever placed completely perfectly.
That's a really great point. And you know, like it reminds me of that cabin breakdown that Blender Guru made. You remember that one?
Oh, I think I saw a bit of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Is such a great video. Y'all should check it out. Blender Guru. He walks you through like 20 to 25 minutes, the creation of his cabin, piece of art. And he talks about, like, I've never heard this before. And you just described it very similar to how he did. And basically what he says is like, he places his cabin, he scatters his trees, and then he like randomizes the camera's position and its focal length, I think, and the sun position. And every frame is a new position for all of those things. And he hits go, and it just makes like thousands of them overnight. And when he wakes up in the morning, he can toggle through each one and like pick the ones that look the coolest. So it's like a random seed, but for your lighting, your camera angle, and your focal length. So it's a great way to generate ideas very quickly. And I've never done that before, but that's actually a great idea for like what you're describing about randomly generating your environment and then trying to find the cool angles within that. And then of course, hyping those up and building those out once you find something cool, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree. Like it's just, yeah, with maybe for people who've only ever done like structured scenes and structured compositions, that it's like, it really helps like, I don't know, with inspiration. And I guess it's sort of relatable in some ways to like, you know, like, I don't know if everyone's seen like Bob Ross, but you know, you have like happy accidents and like mistakes. Those are all good. Like I've sort of found that sort of imperfection like helps a lot with trying to make something.
Yeah, because it's like, it makes sense because it's a random discovery that works, and it's almost like a gift from heaven that comes down. It's like, oh snap, I wouldn't have been able to do this with my brain, but I recognize with my brain that it's cool, so I should probably roll with that. You know, they say the same thing when you're shooting a movie. Like, you're gonna plan things out as much as possible. When you're making a movie, you're gonna have a storyboard, you're gonna have a script, you're gonna have like pre-visualizations for fight scenes, you're gonna have everything pre-picked out, you're gonna have rehearsals, the actors know they're gonna do it a certain way. But when you get there on the day and randomness, you know, hops into the mix, which it always does, that can be chaotic and stressful. But I think to a great filmmaker or a great artist, that random chaos can be harnessed. And if you're aware of the greatness that comes from that and you can harness it, it's going to like add a level of like magic to your art. And it's so rare that I get that in 3D because everything is just hand placed and hand done. But the way you describe that, man, that's really cool. I'm glad that that element can be brought to this process.
Yeah, it's good to hear. I mean, that's sort of just the way I've always done things. And I know in a lot of cases it's not the best way, but yeah. How I like to do things, I guess.
That's great.
Did you need help? How are you going?
I'm chilling. I'm just, downloading assets and like...
Okay.
I think I will need help when we get to like the material side of things. But yeah, what do you suggest? Okay, if we want to do this random generated version of like what you're talking about, how would we go about doing that right now? What do I need to do to get that going?
So if we had more time, I would suggest using procedural foliage volumes, which involve, you know, you got a lot of foliage assets and you place them all into the volume, and then you have to set all of these parameters and get everything neat so it has like these clusters and all this complicated stuff. But for today, I think once we've got a landscape that looks decent, I think we'll chuck a bunch of foliage into the foliage painter and then just sort of semi-randomly, you know, like place clusters of trees here and there. I think that's the best way to do things. It's often, for me, it's like I like to do things a bit more quickly than spending hours like arranging procedural foliage volumes.
Got you. Okay, so maybe the randomness style isn't the best way to go for this stream right now because we're on a limited time.
I mean, it's still somewhat random. Like, we're still going to import like a height map for the landscape, hopefully, and then when we paint, we're just going to paint with like a huge brush. So if we set like the density of trees, and then we just paint over a section, we'll get like an even distribution of the trees.
Cool.
So yeah, there'll still be like a random element to it for sure.
All right, sounds good. What am I missing?
It looks like you got a bunch of stuff. I think I'll help you get your landscape set up properly.
Sweet.
So we've got pretty much the same setup right now. Like, we've both got a bunch of assets that we've dragged in. You got some nice snow assets, which looks great. I've set up my landscape material so that I've been able to paint a couple of surfaces on the ground. So where are you at with that? Have you made a material instance? Yeah.
I've made the material instance, but I don't have any materials plugged in. So maybe I should find a couple materials to drop into that instance. I would assume that's probably the way to go. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So if you've found any surface materials that you want to use from Megascans, you can either, I guess I've dragged in the textures manually, but you're welcome to like import them and then you can still use the same texture.
Yeah. Let me, okay. So I'm going to download a couple materials here, a couple snowy materials, and then we're going to manually drag them in and drop them into your custom instance. Is that correct?
Yeah, essentially. Yeah.
All right, cool.
I'll have to tell you how to set everything up, but at the moment, so I had to create the instance, put in all of the textures in their respective slots, and then after that, you have to open up the landscape painter mode, and then you'll have to make landscape layer files. So it's not very complicated. You just have to click, like, when you create a new layer, you just click create weight blended layer, and then that's essentially it.
Okay, all right, we'll get there. Let's see. I should download a variety of snow textures, I'm assuming, right?
Yeah, so the maximum is, well, for the material I've designed is 4 textures. And I usually like to include, yeah, just a bit of variance. Like, you don't necessarily have to use all the textures. I guess if you've just got like one significant like snow texture and one maybe rock texture, if that's what you're going with, I think that should be fine.
All right, sounds good. Sounds great. All right, I'm almost done here. So I need to navigate to the files actually on my computer and drag them in. Okay.
I think you can just import them. It does create material instances, but you can't use those as long as, yeah, I think exporting using the plugin should be fine.
Okay.
It imports the textures as well. Yeah.
All right, let me do this then. Let's do, right, we're chilling in here. Let's bring in this like snow trampled material. Let's grab this wind swept snowy stones material, and there's like a fresh wind swept snow. I think any one of these will be fine. Grab that. Okay. All right, and those all, because we got our Megascans plugin set up, those are all coming up into our scene right now. So I have 3. Which I think will be fine, cool. I guess, for doing this.
I might explain about something I really love in landscape materials, which is the contact shadows. So regretfully, before the stream, I didn't really have the time, but I would have loved to include like height maps with each of the textures. So what I'm doing right now is I'm just like putting in new texture samples to sample a displacement texture just to sort of demonstrate this effect. But
well, question first, do you have a visual example of what you're talking about right now?
Not right now. I'd have to get that set up first. But so contact shadows are essentially just like really detailed shadows. When you have your lighting in Unreal, the default that comes from a directional light is cascade shadows, and they look great and they respond to moving objects and everything, which is awesome. But if you like zoom in really close, to like the edge of an object in the scene, there's not really any detail there. You'd have to like really bump up you'd have to step up the quality, which is like a huge performance hit.
So you're talking about this scene between the tree and the ground. There's just like a nasty hard line, that seam right there, right?
Yeah, so the shadow sort of cuts off halfway. If I just enable contact shadows real quick, you'll know what I'm talking about. So you sort of see like the detail doesn't extend very far because contact shadows only sample like two objects that are a really short distance away from each other.
Okay.
But around objects, like maybe I'll find something, for example. So if I have something that's sort of half blending in and out of the landscape, this isn't perfectly blended just yet, but you'll sort of see just like much more detailed shadows come from the object, as opposed to if I turn off contact shadows, then they disappear. So,
got you. Okay.
Yeah, that's what contact shadows are. And contact shadows in general, I suppose it's worth mentioning, like when I design my scenes, I design with optimization. Like considering I want to use these environments in real time, it's not always a choice that you need to make if you're just exporting some renders with like some nice ray traced lighting, but these tricks and things I'll be showing will mostly be with the mindset of like creating an optimized environment.
So what you're saying is that contact shadow that looks realistic, if you were to have that on literally every single piece of geometry that you're scattering across your scene, your frame rate would drop considerably and you wouldn't be able to have like a 60 FPS experience in your game.
So what I'm saying is contact shadows are essentially like a technique you would only use for games because it's very efficient. Like you can essentially have contact shadows over the entire scene, as many as you want, for free because it's a screen space effect. Like it's very cheap.
Gotcha.
So what I'm saying is like if you were to do this with ray tracing, you'll have to like pump up the settings a lot, or just like have that kind of outlook over the scene in general. But contact shadows are just sort of like a trick, if that makes sense. Like a trick that helps like get some nice details in where there are like small changes in the geometry. Obviously, when you get larger distances or you get really close to it, it sort of like dissolves, like you can see here. But yeah, it's very much like an optimization trick to get some really nice details.
Sweet.
And once I get these contact shadows set up within the material, so within the landscape material, it's essentially, yeah, it's the same thing, but it's embedded into the material. So even if you don't have any geometric detail in the material, so no displacement and no bumps or anything, if you have contact shadows turned on and you have this bunch of arithmetic here enabled, it will allow for like some shadows to come in on the landscape. Yeah, it's just sort of like a neat trick. Hopefully I'll be able to get something that's presentable.
Yeah, sounds good. I think right now I need to catch up to where you're at as far as let's see. Do we want to scatter some stuff around and start to build a scene? And then once we have something, let me ask you this. Do you want to do the contact shadow thing now? Do you want to set that up now? Or do you want to start building a scene? What would you prefer?
I usually leave scene building to like almost near the end.
So, okay, cool.
Yeah, I think I'll do my contact shadows while you're still working, if you're slightly behind. If you got the landscape set up?
I have my materials downloaded, but I don't have anything dropped into that instance. I don't have any, like, yeah, I don't have that stuff set up.
Okay, cool. So, I guess I can, I'll talk you through it just so we can progress at the same rate.
Yeah.
Let me know once you got the landscape material instance up.
Okay. Just want to quickly shout out a couple people. One Dead Duck, I appreciate you for that super chat there. Yes, I can export multiple items at once from Quixel. Thank you. Good stuff. What else? Alex, thank you for that super chat as well. I love a good snowy embankment as well. That's why I'm putting that one together. I'm very excited about this. So we're going to get this ground plane going and get our, you know, I've never done this before, so I am at your whim here. So we got in the masters folder under what? Was it material functions? Nope.
Yep, so content masters and landscape masters is where I put the materials.
Got it. Okay, so I'm in the instance right now.
Cool. So if you scroll down to global texture parameter values, you'll see a bunch like normal one, normal two.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where you'll put in all of your textures. So if you decide which ones you're going to allocate to be like the number one, number two, you would slot in the albedo into the albedo slot, and then you would slot the corresponding normal map to the normal part.
Got you. So it's just normal and albedo. That's all we really need.
Yeah, that's all we're dealing with. A lot of materials go into like specular maps, all sorts of stuff. This material specifically, I've decided to reference the albedo as a specular map, just to sort of save performance. That's how I like to approach it.
Got you.
Because I figured with a lot of albedo, you can actually draw some specular detail, like depending on the surface, obviously. But for a lot of my purposes, I found that referencing the albedo for specular works pretty well. It's what I like to go with.
All right, so and I got everything dropped maps. In here.
Cool. And then I love to include my displacement maps. Obviously, my preference is not to include that as a separate texture parameter. My choice is often to embed the displacement map into the albedo with Photoshop. You can like modify the alpha channel so that it displays the displacement map. So in the material, you just reference the colors, and then from the alpha, you reference the displacement. And I found that that's a great performance saver. I don't know if that'll make sense to many people, but I just thought I'd put it out there.
It's a high level tip that half makes sense to me. And I think if I don't know if we get to a point where you can show the difference between, like at the end, show the difference between what it looks like with or without. But I think for the people that makes sense to, I'm sure they're like, heck yeah. Absolutely. I'm such a, like I said, I'm such a noob and I'm like trying to follow here. So I really appreciate your patience with me as we're as we're creating
that's,
this together.
That's my problem.
And Evolver, what's up? Good to see you. Welcome back. Thank you for the super chat. Thanks for the support and thanks for everyone just hanging out with us and chilling. We got a steady viewer group here. Appreciate y'all.
Sort of apologize for like really concentrating on the project. I'm like, maybe I'm pushing this too hard. Like I really want to get something out at the end of the 2 hours, but
nah, yeah,
I'm meaning
we'll
to read
fine.
Through the chat for a bit.
We'll be good. We'll be good. So I got this like material instance set up. What's the next step? How do I like visualize this? How do I use this?
Okay, cool. So if you have your landscape selected in the details panel, you'll be able to insert your landscape material instance where it says landscape material.
Got it. Okay, so it's just darkness.
So yeah, that should mean it's working.
Great.
So I think I'm looking at your screen now. Actually, it's probably a bit delayed because of the screen. But so once you've got that set up, you'll want to go into landscape painting mode by pressing shift two. And then you'll see a bunch of slots. For each of them, you have to press the plus icon, which says create layer info. And then you'll want to save a weight blended layer.
All right, I'm switching over to you.
I guess. Okay, cool.
So in target layers in the height map area, or because I'm trying to find out where that is.
So if you're in landscape painting mode, it should be just in the landscape tab.
Got you. Yeah, I'm in the landscape tab. Sculpt, tool settings, brush settings, target layers.
Yeah. So in the layers, you'll see like just something empty. So if you press the plus icon, it says create layer info. I've already done this for my landscape, by the way, but once you have those created, you'll be able to paint some textures onto the landscape.
Okay, I'm trying to find where this plus button is. I feel like such a noob right now. It's all good.
No, no, that's all good. That's all good.
Is it add components to the landscape? Sculpt. Paint. Here we go. I had to go to the paint tab. Right up in here. So it was at manage, and I wanted to go to paint. And there, I can see these textures. Okay, so it looks like I already have them there. And I probably want to rid of this texture 4. Can I just delete that?
I think texture 4 you'll have to leave there for now. Okay. So I think for my project I was able to get, I've got my contact shadows working, so I guess I can show that off quickly.
Okay, I'm running into errors and problems, but here, let's switch over. Alright, go for it. Oh, I think we...
More visible.
I can't hear you. Oh, there we go.
I haven't done anything.
Yeah, I thought you were talking, but I couldn't hear you. Yeah, we're set.
Okay. Oh, no. All good. Okay. So, yeah, I've got my contact shadows enabled at the moment, so if I go ahead and turn those on and off in the directional light... So, it's hard to see, kind of, but maybe the texture's at too small a scale. The light's not at a different angle. But you can sort of see, like, you know, like, where the normal, like, has a little bump. There's, like, just a short shadow coming down. I might work on making that a bit more prominent, but...
Can you slide through it again, before and after?
So that's
oh yeah
with, and that's without.
So this is currently without, or this is currently with?
I'm not sure. It's not very noticeable. Okay, maybe I'll work on it a little bit more. So
the darker, flatter version is without, and then the more like sharpened version is with.
I might work on making a better example for that, because it's not too obvious, but I really wanted to just talk about like material contact shadows, because when I first discovered it, I was like, oh, this is amazing, all this detail.
This is something that you discovered from the Australia pack, right? Is that what you said?
Yes. Yeah. So from the Australia pack on the Unreal Marketplace, which is for free. I downloaded that and I looked through the materials because the creator of the Australian pack, Andrew Spanberg Hamilton, he was like a developer at DICE for a long time. He like has a lot of experience. I just really wanted to like dive into his material design, see what he's doing, like see what like the best material design is. And yeah, that's how I learned the technique.
That's awesome. Yeah, this is all free too, by the way. You can download this for free and hop in and explore this, and like you just basically reverse engineered what Andrew did to discover that technique. Yeah. That's cool. Yeah, that's awesome. This is such
if
a
you don't
beautiful.
Mind.
Mm. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, it's an amazing pack. It's like, yeah, amazing. I think I might try and move on to like getting my landscape like height maps and looking good. If you feel like you're struggling with anything, just give me a shout.
Sounds good. Yeah, go for it. So I might just cheat it.
Yeah, so for the people who haven't been watching since the start, we're making like a Nepalese inspired winter landscape. If my screen's still up, I'll just pull the video up again.
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah, just in case. So, from these vlogs by Craig Adams, he does a lot of hiking videos, and we found like this nice like Nepalese like hiking trail. So I thought I would have a go at trying to recreate it. So yeah, that's what we're doing at the moment. Obviously, not very far yet, but we'll just see how we go.
So you're trying to throw out
I think it's important.
A height map or a displacement, yeah?
Yeah, I was gonna create another landscape from scratch. I just deleted my old one, and then I'm gonna import the file. Yeah, doing this stream has made me realize how bad I am at like working while
dude, talking. It's really difficult to do. It's very difficult to focus on like very minute things, and it's like you feel like people, you're like, oh, who cares about this one little thing, but like people actually love it. They eat this stuff up, man. It's freaking awesome to.
Yeah, Will Fochet, he's really good at it. Wonder if he's still here.
Yeah, he's killer. I actually never watched his one of his streams before, but definitely would like to in the future here.
Yeah, I'm almost. It sucks that I miss most of your streams as well, because for the most part they're like from 1 a.m. till 4 a.m.
yeah, it's all good.
Yeah, if I'm pulling a bender, like working on something, I always have it like in the corner. It's really good.
So what are you up to right now? What are you doing in your scene?
I've got my height map in, which is looking all right. I think I might just go ahead.
Oh, that's awesome.
Okay. We got some weird looking. I mean, I think I know what's wrong here. Like I've imported a file that's like not nearly high enough resolution. So we've got all these lines looking like Minecraft here.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think I can fix this pretty easily if I just like go and let it smooth the landscape sculpting tool. I think I'll somewhat go into like concentration mode so I can get something together. I think after this I'm gonna jump into like getting my sky dome set up, so like with my HDRI.
Sounds good. I'll be moving some pieces around on my end.
Yeah, sounds good. Once you've got your asset set up and you've got your landscape working, like being able to paint materials, I think we'll get our skybox set up.
Sounds good.
On the chat as well. It looks like a bit depth issue. Yeah. Yeah, it was just like an awful quality JPEG that I put together in Photoshop.
Shoot.
That would make sense. But you know, like even if it's a bad quality JPEG, like it's enough to just get like the outline there, and then you can go in with the smooth tool and just like make everything look much more smooth. That's what I'm doing right now.
Sweet. That's a good tip. Because then you're essentially you're going to throw your landscape material on top of that. That's the one that like switches between 3 to 4 materials, right?
That right now. I was going to mention quickly where I got my height map from. I use a website that I forgot the name, so I'll just look it up quickly. It's called tantrams.github.io/heightmapper. And on my screen, I've got it now. It's like a pretty much a world map of that's been height mapped, and so you can zoom in on any part of it that you'd like, and then you can extract, you can render out like a short screenshot of the height map, which is pretty cool. I found it doesn't have a lot of really close detail, but yeah, for large landscapes, I found it to be pretty helpful. Like for this scene, I just got like a little excerpt of like the Himalayas. I have no idea which part of the Himalayas, but I just like chose a little spot.
That's incredible. Could you can you actually grab that link for the audience? Can you paste that in the chat?
Yeah.
That's a great resource.
Yeah, I forgot how I found it actually. Oh, I probably posted it twice. Just an idiot. Yeah, I found like there are tons of resources for height maps, but I found it's just so easy to just like open a browser tab and yeah, just get a height map just like that.
That's amazing. Let's see. Yeah, I'm having trouble here. It's giving me this error. It says this layer has no layer info assigned yet. You must create or assign a layer info before you can paint this layer.
Okay. So on my screen now, I've got my landscape paint option open. And so you've got your target layers, right? And you've got your like slots, your four slots.
Yes, four slots.
Yeah. So see how it has none after each of the labels?
Yeah.
So on the far right, there's a little plus sign, which is create layer info.
Yeah.
And so with that, you create a weight blended layer and you can save that anywhere in your content directory. And after that, it'll essentially reference that layer.
Oh, okay.
So all does right. That sound clear? Is that working?
Yeah, that should be. Yeah.
Cool.
Oh, snap. Okay. Yep. I'm seeing things now. That's fantastic.
So the reason we go weight blended layer instead of a non-weight blended layer is because in most of my landscape materials, I like to reference a displacement map. And that just gives a really nice transition, I suppose, between materials. It references the height map and then it like sort of overlaps them in a more natural way.
Sweet. I'm so excited to be learning all this stuff and can't wait to like figure out this workflow here. Dang, I'm still getting the thing. This layer has no layer info assigned yet. I have assigned all four layers. What is going on?
Oh, that's strange. I mean, for me, once the layer was created and I can see it in my landscape tab, it didn't say none. It says the layer that I just made, and then I'm able to do some painting.
Hmm. I don't know why it still says nay. Target layers. See, I don't think I'm supposed to do anything else.
Oh shoot, someone in the chat just says one of my best friends was part of the leads for the mission that got the data for the height map that we're using. How cool is that?
Oh snap. Wait, I know this guy. I know Hunter. Oh snap, that's awesome. Wow, that's super crazy. Small world.
Is this us working in DirectX 11? Yes. Me at least. I'm not going to be relying on any ray tracing for this project. We're just going with traditional dynamic lighting.
Hey Caves, did you get that height map link, by the way? I don't think I saw it in the chat.
Yeah, I posted it in the chat. I can do it again.
You did? Wait, Soto, do you see it?
I guess I don't come up as a moderator, so it sort of blends in. But
I didn't see a link. That's weird. You can send it to me on Discord.
Okay, yeah, I'll do that.
Sweet,
oh, sorry for the coughing. I just like swallowed my coffee in the wrong way.
Oh, dude, you're all good. Sweet. All right, pinned it. That's a really cool service they got here for free too. What the heck? How you doing? How you looking?
On my end, I'm just about. Yeah, I'm just about ready. Like, I've got a landscape that looks like kind of ugly at the moment, but I'm just about ready to like start laying down some trees and whatnot.
All right, I'm gonna need your help. I need you to help a noob out here.
Cool.
So I am currently at a point where like I'm trying to paint, but it's not. It's still giving me this error that this layer has no layer info assigned yet, and then you have to create or assign a layer info before you can paint the layer. But everything on the left is basically assigned. I added the plus sign to everything.
Okay.
So I'm not really
sure. So it doesn't say none anymore underneath the label?
No.
Okay.
Is that a restart?
Did you make a weight blended layer or the other type?
No, it's the first option. The one that says parentheses normal.
Okay. Oh man, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's probably just doing some noob thing that's like,
I mean, if you want, you can screen share on Discord really quick, or...
Let me just try and restart it. Let me restart my program. I'm going to switch over to
Good
you.
Good work. All right, in that case, at the moment, I'm just tweaking my landscape materials because everything's looking a bit funny at the moment.
I'm holding you back, Caves.
No. Not at all. I love this vibe. I love this is like a one-on-one tutorial. It's great. No, it's awesome. It's awesome to be able to, just like help give you a kickstart. I know that you've been eyeing down Unreal for a long time. Like, I'd love to be able to help you like make the stuff that you want to make. Like, there's nothing worse than just like, dealing with a program, just like not knowing where the buttons are and stuff. So.
Yeah, it's tough at first. It's like you're crawling through the program. Hey, it works now, man. A little restart.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, a little restart. I'll do
it.
Oh,
nice.
For some reason, it's gray, though. There's like parts that are like gray, like camouflage or something, but that's fine. We can move on. That is strange. Why is it doing that? You see this by chance? Like, looks like camouflage. Should be white, right? It's snow. Is it this one? Is it? No, it's not that.
Oh, I think I know what you mean. So if you open your material instance, that's because of the macro variation that I included. And I think by default, I accidentally set that to full. So if you search in the details panel macro, you'll be able to set your macro intensity to 0.
Dude, somebody knows what they're talking about. Snap. Yeah,
When you're ready, should we get into like Skybox and like...
Let's do it.
Is she all right? Cool.
Let's do it.
So let's go through this together because we're both sort of on the same level. So if you go into engine content in your content browser, search Sky... Yeah. And drag that into the scene and go to details and scale that up to like 500.
Okay, you said one more time. You said in the content browser, do what now?
The content browser, so you're able to find engine content. There's like a panel on the very side that you can pop out, like a list. And from there, you select engine content and then you can search within that folder.
Engine content. I'm in content, the content folder. Let me switch to you. Oh, you show. It's so tiny.
So
I'm gonna get this over here.
I can zoom in. It's just this tab here. You can like select this window.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I'm on that.
And then select engine content, and then from there in the search bar, you can just search SkySphere.
Oh, weird. I'm not seeing that folder. That engine content folder.
Oh, that's strange. So does it just say content for you?
Yeah, it just says content, yeah.
I wonder if that's like a project setting that I changed like years ago.
Yeah, just content. I could like add.
That's unreal for you.
I could add a feature or a pack, content pack, starter content or something. It's like, I don't know if that's this is what I need to be doing, but probably not.
Yeah, just search project settings.
Anyway, here you go for it. You add it, and then I think I have enough info to like add a height or what is it? Exponential height fog. I can add some of that and like work my sun.
Yeah, yeah.
I can get that far. But yeah, why don't you go for it?
So I've just put in my sky sphere, and I just like to take that mesh from the content files because it saves you having to import it yourself. And now in our masters folder, I've got a material that's set up for sky spheres. So I'm gonna. Create an instance. Oh, have I got the wrong material? Oh no. So I'll be able to put something in, but it's not going to be projected correctly. I'm just going to import my sky texture quickly.
Oh, William's still in the chat, and he's giving me the. So he says you need to go to view options in the bottom right of your content browser. Got you. And then drop open will allow you to show engine content. Show engine content. Yes. Checkbox. Show engine content. William, you're a lifesaver. Thank you. Much appreciated. So now on the left, I can see if. Dang, my head is in the way. Big old head is in the way. But I have that pack now. Engine content. And you said sky sphere?
Yeah.
Matt, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still there.
What was the thing to search
for? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sky sphere.
And it's a folder. Is that right? Sky atmosphere?
It's a mesh. So if you have the engine content selected in the left pane, you should be able to search sky sphere, and then it should be the first option.
Oh boy.
It's like a static mesh. And you can just drag that into the scene.
I'm just getting. This must be. Okay, look. This must be rough for people who know what's going on. Apologies. I am. My fingernails. I'm just hanging on by my fingernails, scraping, trying to keep up with a master working his magic right now. Woo! Oh man. We're gonna get there. We're gonna get there. I appreciate everyone's patience. This is what happens when you don't know how to use this program, you know? This is what happens when you don't know how to use this program. You make a fool of yourself.
I mean, the thing that irks me about Unreal is like, you know, that option was just like a thing hidden away in project settings, you know, and you never know to like search for it or where to find it. I found that some really crucial settings just boil down to that, you know, that one checkbox and you have no idea where it is. That's frustrating.
Brutal. It's like you move into a new house. It's a mansion. It's like that's the biggest house you've ever been to. And all your stuff is just scattered around. And you're like, I thought, like, how am I supposed to know it was up in the attic in this drawer under the floorboard? Like, how am I supposed to know where these buttons are? But, you know, you hang out with Matt, you hang out with William, and you watch their videos and their tutorials. And then, you know, then you figure out, oh, that is under the floorboard. I'm going to move it into my pocket. I'm going to have it in my pocket for next time. So thanks for your patience, dude. I think I found it, though.
No,
dude.
No,
it's
no problem.
Skysphere material. Which one? There's four sky spheres.
It's just the static mesh that you need. Now.
And I just drag it out into the sky.
Yeah, or onto the landscape.
Or onto the landscape.
So I wish I could see.
What's the name of it? I have four names here. I have editor Skysphere material SM Skysphere SM Sky. I have two SM Skyspheres. I'm searching it. Everyone's like, everyone's
editor Skysphere.
Full alert, editor Skysphere. Okay, and I just drag that into the scene. Okay, my sky went gray, so looks a little. Let's see. Where is that even?
Or you just drag it. I think drag it onto the landscape, so it's placed like right in the middle.
I think I'm probably doing the wrong thing. You got to drag BP Skysphere. Okay. Thank you, chat. I really appreciate you. BP Skysphere. All right. Yeah, okay. Sky just turned all orange and stuff. I just don't know where it went, though, because it's like I'm applying it to something. Is it an actor that is like in the scene? Or is it a material?
It's like essentially an actor with the normals that are inverted, so it can only be viewed from the inside.
Show me on your screen. What does that look like? Where is that? Where would you click on it?
At the moment, I've got it scaled up 500 times, so that's why it's like covering the sky. But if I put it right back down to one, you'll see just like a dome, like a weird texture projected.
All right, and show me where you're getting that from.
All right, so engine content, search Skysphere. There is this editor Skysphere here that I just dragged in.
Editor Skysphere, yeah. Okay.
So I put that on the landscape just so it's like placed in the center and I can work with it. And then in the details panel, when you've got that selected, you scale it up around 500 times. You can do more if you want.
All right, give me a second.
And that essentially just wraps the entire scene inside the sphere.
Okay, it's weird because I don't think I'm seeing it in my content browser. Or sorry, the world outliner. I'm not seeing it in my world outliner, so I don't know where it is in my scene.
Okay, if it's not in your world outliner, it might not be in scene properly. Like if you drag it onto the like the background where there is no background, it might not be placed correctly.
I'm probably doing this wrong. Cause the chat is yelling at me to like sky. BP Skysphere. Yeah, I don't know if I'm like. It's weird because like based on your screen, I'm dragging the correct thing based off of like this Discord view of the screen share of my other computer. but yeah, I don't know. It just looks like a massive gray box. The sky goes. Wait, look. What is being added? Oh, I see. Okay, no, there it is. But why the heck is it grayed out like that? Why is everything grayed out?
It's strange.
Jeez. Cursed.
I wish, yeah, it's such a shame I can't see a real-time update of your screen. Otherwise, I'd be able to help you.
So, I just went full screen on me, but everything else is grayed out besides... Oh, it's... It's because I'm in paint mode, I would assume.
Oh, maybe that's my bad.
I need to switch to select. Oh, goodness.
So select would be shift 1.
There we go. And I think this
thing
is like...
that's my bad.
Utterly massive, which is why it's encompassing the whole screen. Okay, yep. So it's just a gray blob right now is what this thing is.
I guess I may as well mention, like, it's slightly, with the newer versions of Unreal, it's slightly less obvious which mode you're in currently. Like, I'm just so used to pressing, like, shift 1, shift 2, shift 3 to change between. But yeah, that's a prominent thing. Like, if you're in the foliage editing mode and you want to move an object, you would have to change to shift 1, which is just, like, the object's editing mode.
Dude, that's
before you can do anything.
So good to know. Oh, man.
Yeah, that's my bad, man. Sorry, should I give you that tip?
It's all good, man. It's like I said, my fingernails are bleeding from crawling and just trying to make it work. But you know, I think I just took my first step. So I know exactly that I need to be in select mode, shift one, in order to move stuff around. So, okay, yo, we got our editor SkySphere up in here. I'm maxing it out. Like, it came in as, it's totally encompassing my entire scene. It's just a gray void, which,
cool. So, yeah. So what I did was I went into masters, it's in the content browser, masters, backdrops, and then I've got a material called backdrop, which I created an instance, and then from that instance I feeded in a custom texture. Now, I actually forgot to include, like, there's a version of the material that lets you reference a HDRI, and then it maps it around you, but turns out I forgot to include that version of the material. So for now, it's just an image reference. So if you have any HDRI that you can bring in as an image, like a JPEG or PNG.
Oh, interesting.
It will work. It just means the bottom half of the sphere will have to be obscured. Like on my screen, if I disable the fog, it'll be like a repeat of the clouds.
Got you. Okay, so that's a JPEG? Or you have an HDRI, and I need to get a JPEG as well?
I used a JPEG. I had a JPEG version of the same image I was going to use. I just chucked that in. So.
Okay. I can find something as we move forward. Cool.
So yeah, what else? Yeah, have you got that sky? You got that sky coming up?
I got it figured out enough. Like, I'm not gonna take any more time to like find a J. I can find a JPEG at some point, but gray right now is fine. I don't really need, unless it's crucial to like figuring out what the lighting is here, because I can see that the sun is poking through. So we're gonna probably, are we? Is this HDRI like faking the sky essentially, and then? Or this JPEG rather, and then we actually choose the lighting based off the sun? Is that how it works?
Yeah, essentially. I mean, ideally you would like line up the direction of the sun with wherever the sun is coming from in the HDRI.
Yeah, of course.
Like, obviously, actually, like, this is just my process. You don't have to use a HDRI backdrop for your scene. Like, a lot of people, especially recently, are utilizing like all the volumetric fog stuff, all the sky atmosphere stuff, which looks amazing. Yeah, I just wanted to go with this because I really enjoy using like a really high quality picture instead of using the like cloud volumetrics, because I love the cloud volumetrics, but I found that when you compare the two, it's like with a static image you just get much more detail in some spots, and everything looks like overall just a bit more real.
Sweet.
Like on my screen at the moment, I've got just like, yeah, some really nicely shaped clouds. Yeah, so that's what I thought. I would just like do things the way I usually handle things.
Yeah, absolutely.
Actually, on your side, if you felt like just like dragging in a sky atmosphere asset and then a volumetric cloud asset, you'll have like a very similar effect, and you'll have like your own custom sky, which is probably actually a much easier way of doing things.
Yeah, let me give that a shot. So you said a sky atmosphere actor. And yeah, what else?
So I guess you can hide the current sky sphere if you want, for now.
The skylight? Or the sky sphere that we dropped in.
Yeah, the mesh. Yeah. So you would go into your details panel and uncheck visible, or you can just hide it from the world outliner.
Yeah, it's hidden.
And so yeah, just drag in a sky atmosphere asset and then a volumetric cloud asset, and I think you'll have to go to your directional light and then search sphere, and then you have to check atmosphere sunlight in your directional light.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet. You know, we got some clouds up in here. The first thing you said to add was a what? A volumetric cloud and a what?
And a sky atmosphere.
Got you.
And that stuff, yeah, it's so useful for getting something that looks automatically like really great, and it like reacts to like the direction of the sun and everything.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's like it's super great. Epic comes out with like so much amazing stuff, man.
Oh wow, that's really cool. That's great. These are basics.
If you want to stick with that.
Yeah, I'm gonna stick with this. Yeah. I'm gonna go easy mode.
No. I reckon like you'll have some like dynamic movement stuff going on that'll look better than my scene. So yeah. Stick with that. All right, I reckon for now let's go through like our lighting setup. I'm just gonna like place some trees down and do a bit of painting.
Cool.
And then I'll get straight into lighting because that we can both do at the same time.
Sounds good. So I'll place some stuff as well.
Yeah, if you want. So have you used the foliage tool much?
A little. Shift 3, right?
Yeah, Shift 3. And then I've just selected a bunch of static meshes from my content browser and I've dragged those in for that pane. Now I'm just going to start painting some stuff.
So you can drop your trees in there and stuff.
Yeah. I've just dropped in a bunch of trees for the moment.
All right. I'll try and do the same. And then how do you do, like, would you add sticks to that as well? Or would you...
Yeah. I mean, if you want something. So you just did the same thing as me. Like it's all really dense at the start. But if you just, like, dial down the density down to, like, I've got, like, 0.03.
Ooh-wee.
0.02. And another tip is to... in the foliage tab, if you select all of your instances and then go to the option that says align to normal, it means all of your trees won't bend to the direction of the landscape. So I think you've got a flat landscape, so it should be fine. But in my case, I've got a bunch of hills, so it just helps having all the trees being upright instead of pointing.
Yes.
In the direction.
Yes, exactly. Align to normal is checked. Okay, so. Basically, if I add hills later, they will stay upright as well. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's right.
Sweet, okay.
So I've found out that a lot of the trees aren't particularly optimized. Like, I have a whole process for like creating billboards for trees and foliage that... will utilize it effectively, but for now I don't think I've got time to do that.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
But yeah, billboards, for those that don't know, is an effective way of just like saving performance when you've got trees in the distance. It essentially swaps the 3D model out with a flat plane or like a very simple mesh, and then the goal is to get that transition between the full quality mesh and the billboard to be as seamless as possible. So once you're moving away from it, it like transitions and then you get that performance boost as soon as the high quality model is loaded out.
That's incredible, man. Have you ever thought of making tutorials? Because I feel like this knowledge that you're dishing out here, like we could, each one of these things that you're saying could just be unpacked and like dived into.
Oh, it's very nice of you to say that. I might do someday. I guess whenever I sit down at the computer, I really just, all I can be motivated to do is just like work on something.
Yeah.
Like a project as opposed to making a tutorial. But maybe someday, I definitely have some tricks that it took a while for me to search for.
Yeah.
That could be useful for a lot of people, but yeah, it's just a matter of I don't know if I'm a good public speaker or not. I don't know if I'm good at that whole like YouTube format and making tutorials. So.
Hey guys, you just gotta like amp yourself up. You gotta start with hey guys really intensely. Hey guys, what's up? And then you just, you know, then the rest just flows, you know.
Yeah. Do 10 push-ups before you record.
Mm-hmm. Which is hilarious because that's what literally I was like, yeah, I just do some push-ups before we go live.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great recommendation. Like, I'm gonna start doing that before my Zoom calls, maybe.
It helps. Like, this stream, I didn't need to, just because it's more of a chill situation. But when you gotta like get all hyped and stuff, you know, it's a great way to get going. Question for you. I know there's a noob. This is a noob question. So, I'm in Shift F3 mode. I am in foliage painting mode. That is confirmed. But my brush went away. I can't see anything anymore, and I'm clicking on the landscape, and nothing is spawning. Do you know why?
I'm not too sure. It might be because your foliage instances aren't selected. So in the pane, you'll have to go over and like tick all those boxes where each of the trees are.
They're all ticked. Yeah.
Okay. And in that case, just check like the size of your brush, which comes up in like the tab.
Yeah, I hadn't touched that. That remains the same. Yeah. Density was the only thing that's changed.
Okay, that's strange.
And I have paint selected, the paint brush selected.
I mean, you say I'd be good at tutorials, but I'm sorry that I can't like help out with these kinds of problems. Yeah, kind of at a loss. I'm just sort of watching a couple seconds late.
I wonder if I have to have the landscape selected.
Your landscape's looking nice though. Like the normals are picking up the light and stuff. Got some painting going on.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. We'll get there.
I think I've almost like made a landscape look too big. Like definitely getting some frame issues.
Yeah, keep it small. Keep it super small.
I might suggest like in your case, you're probably better off just going with that small square that I put in the project at the start.
Oh, that's exactly. I'm not even gonna try and go outside of this zone. That's pretty sweet. All right, well, wow.
Is that working again for you? Or
no, my brush is gone, but it's all good. You keep doing your thing. Don't let me slow
I think
you down.
we can both do our lighting setups at the same time, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Definitely a lot to go into. So just a time check. So it's nearly 3 a.m. for me here. I think I'm very happy to keep going. I really want to get something somewhat complete.
Yeah, why don't you just bust it out? Just like you go off. Like I'll be chilling back here, you know, dabbling with this thing. But why don't you just tear it up? You know, take as much time as you have to put something together and like explain as you can, as you can and if possible. Cool. But yeah, go for it.
Right, but I guess we may as well do our like lighting setup together because that's essentially we're both ready.
Let's do it. Yeah.
So first off, I always change all my lights to movable, and this is like a trick that I overlooked when I was starting, and it frustrated the hell out of me. So yeah, if you go to movable, that essentially means that like the light is essentially dynamic; it has no built-in effects. What you see is what the final product will look like. So with the skylight and directional light, we both want those to be set to movable. And the way the project is set up, I just put like the default values for both light and the skylight. So from here, I wanted to show distance fields. So I think that's worth sharing. So I enabled that within the project before I send it over, so it should be enabled. But for those who want to try out distance fields, you have to go into the project settings and then just enable distance fields, restart. So in the directional light, there is a section called distance field shadows, and if you check that and then push the cascaded shadow maps distance all the way down to zero. We're not seeing anything at the moment. It's because I maybe haven't enabled it. There we go. But distance fields are like a really cheap way of getting like some nice detailed shadows. Like with distance fields, if you mess around with your parameters and your directional light, like with the source angle, you can get like this nice like. I guess it looks somewhat messy on my screen at the moment, but you get this nice like transitional effect between objects that are really close to the ground and objects that are a bit further away. So you'll notice that on my screen, you've got like this tree here, when in comparison to the trees in the distance, those trees, like the shadows blurred out because it's further away from the landscape surface, but with the tree that's really close, you get like these nice, like sharp shadows. And also by disabling, to get distilled shadows enabled or like visible all the way up till the camera, you have to reduce the cascaded shadow maps distance to zero.
Can you show on and off? The difference between those?
Okay, so I'm gonna. Okay, yeah. I'm just gonna disable contact shadows. So at the moment we've got distance field shadows, and then if I turn on cascade, it looks like that. So you'll notice, like at the very base, it's not very detailed. The shadow sort of cuts off.
Yeah, it looks like it's floating.
Yeah, so if I turn that all the way down to zero, you get like still a bit of a cutoff. But the idea is, much more crisp shadows with objects that are really close to the ground, and then it sort of fades off into like a more natural gradient. I think the reason this is looking fairly messy at the moment on my screen is because a lot of these trees maybe haven't had their distance field shadow resolution set to the right amount. Like if you have all these artifacts, it means you have to bump up your distance field shadow resolution. That makes sense to some people.
That's definitely a lot of settings. Yeah, that need to be tweaked.
I'm totally aware that I'm like jumping up and down between difficulty levels like every minute, so apologize for that.
I'll just be constantly asking questions. So that's
okay, cool.
So basically that harsh shadow line that connects this tree to the ground, that setting is a distance field setting. Is that correct?
Yeah. That, I guess that is also possible with ray tracing, but a way to get that without ray tracing is to use distance field shadows. Actually, I think distance field shadows are a form of ray tracing. Actually, it is ray traced. There are ray traced shadows, but it's such like a performance booster. Like without using ray tracing, I found that if I disable cascade shadows, which is the traditional dynamic shadowing method, like I automatically get like so many frames back. It's great.
This is awesome. So what you're doing is you're optimizing your scene. Your whole workflow is based around optimizing your scene to make it look like it's photoreal, to make it look like it's ray tracing, but it's not.
Essentially, exactly. Yeah. Like because I want my environments to be efficient from the ground up, I just always start with that as a base. Yeah, and once you have that, you can always like tweak values and make things more expensive later on. But the whole idea is to just like, you know, look at photos, try and emulate realistic lights in like the most efficient way possible. And then that's how I put environments together.
What are some resources for people that, like, you're talking about some like very advanced stuff here, some very specific stuff.
I can't remember where I learned this originally. I watched a whole bunch of epic live streams outlining all these features. There is one video particularly on distance fields, which is really useful. Sometimes it's really hard to be aware of these features. Like you'll find that, like for me, contact shadows, I wasn't aware they existed until like much later than I would have wanted. But it was just like, you know, as soon as I knew what they were, I could like search documentation, search like the video coverage. And then that gave like a good amount of information on how to use it.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. So I hope you all have taken notes. Write down these things that you got to look into and dive deep. You know, you can do it with the documentation or just, you know, YouTube your stuff. But from this point, where would you go from here?
Okay, from here, I've sort of got like a vague scene put together snow and trees.
Yeah.
I'm just going to try and put in some more details from here on, like scatter some assets around. I was just about to use the landscape tool to apply a noise painter to get some more like detailed variation on the ground. That's sort of a trick I like to use.
Sweet.
I wanted to say as a disclaimer, like keeping in mind all the stuff I design is that I want to be able to use for like real-time applications. So I love to turn my environments into playable demos and like VR software and things like that. So obviously a lot of these techniques aren't necessarily applicable if you're planning on making a render or producing a scene.
It's great though.
With different like outputs in mind.
Yeah, it's such a different workflow from what I'm used to. And I think there's so much to learn from this. So, you know, as we approach the future and get into the metaverse and whatnot, like creating these virtual environments to play back in VR is going to be huge. And I think knowing all these things to optimize your scene for that kind of setup is going to be very, very, very valuable.
Yeah, so. I agree. And I think even for pushing out like normal renders, like if you have a really large environment, sometimes it's only possible to work with a project that has a large environment if it's optimized. Like if you build it without being careful about like poly counts or texture resolution and things, or if you like aim for like the very highest target of quality right from the beginning.
Yeah.
It's often really hard to work with like a huge environment. Like the good thing about Unreal is all of this like optimization stuff is built in. If you wanted to have a huge environment, you can work on one area, and then as soon as you zoom out, the detail is loaded out, and then you zoom into another area on the other end of the map, like several kilometers away, and then as soon as you put the camera there, all the detail is there.
That's awesome.
Like that's essentially, yeah, like it's essentially what makes Unreal stand out from other renderers, I think. Like other renderers, you have to like stay somewhat confined within like your play space. Like you're not able to like make landscapes that are kilometers long and have that filled with grass just because, you know, it's like impossible to work with. But yeah, Unreal is just about Unreal and Unity, actually. Both Unreal and Unity being real time made for games, it's sort of yeah, it makes sense.
It's such a cool, like, if you can figure out how this sandbox works, it's the coolest thing to explore and like build from. And there are certainly times where like I can get frustrated and overwhelmed with the amount of stuff that Unreal has to offer. And I really appreciate you like, you know, helping us out and pointing us in the right direction where it, at least y'all, you know, like I was saying, please take notes and look up these things, because he's pointing you in a lot of super solid directions here. And of course we only have a limited amount of time here. But there's just so much to unpack. I feel like we could just do this for hours and hours, but it's almost 4 a.m. where you're at. So we're getting to the point here where we'll probably want to like start building out the scene and hopefully getting to the point where we can export an EXE for people to hop into the world and like and explore it for themselves.
Yeah, I think with a bit of a push, I might go into concentration mode for a bit and just like, yeah, see what I can do.
Do it.
That's all good.
I'll switch over to my screen and I'll see what I can do here. I'm trying to go with the simplest version of a scene here. So I'm probably going to crank the fog up a whole bunch at a certain point here. I'm just going to place these around, and you know what? I might even go with a... I've been in Unreal 5 recently, so going back to 4 is like, it's not that bad actually.
Oh yeah, learning Unreal 5 would probably be the right thing to do at this point. I think the engines are pretty similar all in all, but yeah, I think everything will be almost solely in Unreal 5 from here onwards. I just use Unreal 4 because, yeah, I'm slightly unfamiliar with Unreal 5. I've only used it a handful of times, and a lot of the lighting options are much more stable in Unreal Engine 4, considering Unreal Engine 5 still in early access.
Yeah. It's just so beautiful, though, like, the way everything reacts in Unreal 5 and the way everything works together, it just works seamlessly. And there are times where it glitches out, but everything's kind of like preset for you, which is cool.
Yeah, yeah. And with like all of their like lumen, like lighting, I was amazed at how quick you can get like really nice results.
Yeah.
Just by like placing a couple lights in your scene, it's like nuts.
It's absurd.
Oh man, have you seen the Matrix Awakens demo from Epic?
Not yet, no.
Oh man, I saw that yesterday. Like my mind was blown. I work with Unreal all the time, and my mind was blown by that project. Like,
jeez.
They've just been like keeping it secret for a whole year. They suddenly bust out like a photorealistic open world Matrix city. Yeah, it's nuts.
And is it free to download and hop into?
Yeah, I think it's PS5 and Xbox only, so I can't try it. I just have to experience it through a YouTube video. But
same.
But it's like the culmination of like all the tech and all the money they put into like advancing all the stuff they've been working on, and it just like culminates into like that project, and it's just like that's nuts. They went ahead and recreated like some scenes from the original Matrix at the start of the video, which I thought were excerpts from the film. I thought they'd just taken and put in videos, but no, they're like real time Unreal Engine 5 like recreations of scenes from the Matrix. I thought it was sick.
Jeez, that's insane. Yeah, Sam and I think Nick. It was Sam and Peter were telling me about it yesterday, and I didn't know what it was. Like, because I saw Unreal just kept like pushing it on their Instagram, and I'm like, okay, I didn't click it. But I mean, I thought
they're just trying to push their like Matrix license. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but actually it's well worth it. Like the project is, I'm surprised they didn't share anything about it until now. It's like a massive project.
Dang. That it like didn't get leaked or anything.
Yeah. Just looking through the chat, we got Exam here on the East Coast. Yeah. Oh, thanks for sticking around. Uh, 2 a.m. in Vietnam.
That's legit.
I guess this is just about the only time like where everyone is awake, sort of. I guess I wouldn't normally be awake, but
yeah, right. It's like we picked the perfect time. We picked the exact perfect time to do this. The only, yeah, honestly, it was
over here in WA. Someone's in Perth. Someone's in West Australia.
Really?
Hi, in Hudson.
Oh snap!
But yeah, everyone, check out the Epic. The Epic project, The Matrix Awakens. The dialogue is kind of corny, actually, in parts of it, but you want to watch the end of the video because that's where they just, like, walk around the environment and showcase everything. All right, so I'm going to go back into concentration, see what I can get done. I'm happy to spend, like, another 30 minutes on this. That's
plenty. Yeah, that's plenty. I'll bug you about fog settings later, but I'm gonna get everything placed first.
Yeah, I'm gonna get stuck into that pretty soon as well, because I haven't got all that much to work with at the moment. I think some fog will like definitely bring up the ambience a little bit.
It's gonna save my render. I gotta cheat it so hard. I'm gonna like get that super wide aspect ratio. What was it, like 27? 64 by 27? I think. All right, let's see if that paintbrush works.
I'm going to mention something quickly. So I've hooked up all my materials to work with a like snow shader. So I've got a global parameter that I can adjust. So I can import a whole bunch of assets that don't essentially have snow on them. And then once I enable like this shader or I turn up my values, I can get like some nice detailed snow appearing on like the surface of the assets.
What the heck? Okay, okay. What is that? What's going on there? How does that work?
So the master material, the master surface material, references a material function, and that function essentially takes the pixel normal. So each pixel with the direction it's facing, it takes that normal and decides how far upwards it's facing. And if it's facing far enough upwards, it like colors it completely white, and also turns the roughness all the way up.
Okay.
So with that, you get an effect that like the surface that looks like it's facing upwards, it turns that white, and then that's how you get like a nice overlay of snow, and then it's also influenced by the normal texture. So that's how you get like a detailed like gradient. You can see on the rock there's like little bits of snow.
That's great. That's very similar, like in Octane, a fall off node, essentially, where you're like masking out just the parts of the geometry that are facing up towards the sky, and you can use that as a mask for whatever material you want. So that's cool that you can do it here in Unreal. It's just a bit more of a process. If people wanted to look that up, if people wanted to dive deeper into how to do that, what would they Google?
I'm trying to think of how it's hard for me to remember how I learned it, but
no, not specifically, not the specific tutorial, but like just the wording.
I think like there are lots of different ways to achieve it. I think just search like, you know, like snow material function, something along those lines. Because everyone has a different way that they approach it.
Yeah.
And yeah, if you find a YouTube video with something that looks appealing, follow along with that.
Snow material function. All right, cool.
Now, I've realized now that like my performance is like fairly butchered. Like I'm only getting frames, 30 frames a second. Pretty rough. Most of these trees I think are pretty high quality. I'd have to go through and like reduce the LED selection.
Oh boy.
Actually, I could go into like some console commands. Like you've got useful console commands for optimization are like foliage dot LED distance scale. If I change that to 0.2, I just get more frames. Yes, I did. So then that like essentially it essentially changes the distance at which each tree swaps out a lower quality LED.
Ah, I see.
And in doing so, that changed, like, unanimously, it changed all the trees at once. So now I went from 30 frames up to, like, 50 frames just from doing that one command. And there's almost no difference. There's also... huge in LED. So if I said minimum LED for one, that means it doesn't reference LED 0 anymore. It goes straight to LED 1, even at the closest distance.
Was that the force LOD?
That was foliage.minLOD1. What do you say? How are you going? Do you think we should get into like some fog and atmospherics?
Wherever you think you're at, if you want to scatter some like ground stuff,
I might do that in between.
Sure.
Yeah, I've got some ground stuff set up.
Yeah. If you think now's the time ready.
Or if you're still working, you can do it in like 10 minutes.
No, I mean if this works for you, I think it's something that I need to do anyway. So if you feel comfortable going over that right now, then let's do it.
Cool. I just think at the moment, like I'm a little bit, like not that I'm displeased with the scene. I think I got some nice like atmospherics and colors going, but I've just realized like there are so many like things I need to tweak. Like you've got like the ground texture that's the wrong scale. You've got like just like all these material values that I could have like spent some time just like changing. And I'm not sure if I'll get time to change all of those. So in that case, let's see what we can do with lighting and effects, because in my opinion, I think the lighting and like post-processing are done on the scene, like always pulls the most weight, you know, like you can import as many high quality models, textures as you want, like get those looking perfect, but just change a couple of parameters in your post-process and that makes a huge difference, like bigger than anything else that you've done. So,
agreed. It all comes down to lighting and effects. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So I'm going to go ahead and drag in a post-process volume into the scene. And in the details panel, I will go ahead and unbound so that it applies to the camera no matter where it is in the scene, not just in the volume. So with that, you can just like make tweaks and then decide how your scene's gonna look. Actually, we should do fog before we start.
That's the only saving grace for me, so is fog at this point.
No, it's gonna be the same for me as well, actually. We'll see. So I'm gonna you've got your exponential height fog in your scene, right? Okay, so I'm gonna go and enable volumetric fog, so we might get some like nice rays coming down. Bump up my fog density. I'm going to reduce my fog max opacity, so we might get some of the clouds still in the sky. Like, found that it's useful to have a cutoff point so you can still see the sky. If you have fog max opacity at 1, it might shroud out too much of the sky.
It's like a harsh line for me. 0 is completely off, but 0.01 is completely on. Interesting.
I also just realized, if you have distance field shadows enabled right up to the camera, you won't be able to see any volumetric rays. So I'm going to re-enable my cascade shadows just for this. So this is 6,000. I think the main parameter to look at is your extinction for your volume. Fully volumetrics. Like once you start bumping that up, you really start seeing like some ray effects and all sorts of things.
Extinction scale?
Yeah. And then also scattering distribution. If you want like a really dramatic, like strong sun, it's really good to bump up that scattering distribution. And I'm going to go for like a red sunset look. So from the YouTube video that I was referencing.
Oh,
got like some nice red sunrise light. So let's see what I can do. Your scene's looking really good, man. Like, that just shows, like, you don't need a huge landscape to, like, make something impressive.
Yeah, I think I just need so much more time spent with this in order for it to,
even,
like...
Even for me, man, like, I sort of know everything. It's on my fingertips, but then... Yeah, just diving in, I realized like all this stuff, all these details I would normally tweak if I had like hours to spend. And apologies to the chat, like I've really been meaning to like interact with the chat a bit more, like you guys are all taking your time hanging out, but like 250 people or so in here, damn, it's crazy.
Yeah, we're all chilling.
That's snow tiling though, yeah, great stuff. We work with it. We work with it. Why not use RTVs? Not too sure what you mean.
What are RTVs?
RVTs, sorry. I'm not sure what that is.
Real volume
Someone said, why are people choosing Unreal over Blender? I guess, like, big environments, I suppose. I guess I talked about a bit about that before.
To me, they go together. They're a perfect pairing.
No, absolutely. I use Blender. I use Blender for all of my custom-made 3D models. Yeah, I always go for Blender.
Yeah, like, they certainly go together. This is where you put the pieces together, you know, and this is where you do it in real time.
Oh, yeah. Someone brought up a good point with pixel depth. First of all, and virtual texturing. Virtual texturing, I don't personally use. I've experimented with it a little bit. And it's a great way to get, like, your assets blending with your landscape if you want, like, a snow texture to come up the roots of your trees and things like that. But I found that, you know, there are other alternatives, like you mentioned, pixel depth. If you include a pixel depth offset with your landscape material, I suppose I was trying to, like, demonstrate that properly before, but with a pixel depth offset, you can reference a height map, and then when you merge assets with the landscape, it essentially blends them according to the height map, and it's super great. I'll try and get a quick demo of that right now. So I hate this snow tiling as well. Like, I definitely notice it. That's sort of what I put my macro variation in my material for. Like, if I were to bump up my macro intensity,
yeah,
and get the scaling right, that sort of gives enough variation that it sort of gets rid of the tiling a little bit.
That makes sense.
If you have, like, right now I've got, like, a really subtle or, like, turned down, reasonably subtle macro effect on the snow, it, like, helps so much with tiling. Like,
I see what you're doing. Okay, so it's like it's adding noise to the scene to make it.
Yeah, kind of. I also have, like, my textures way too small, which is a problem. So maybe I can demo some of the depth with this. Maybe. I think the pixel depth is strong enough. Like, I think the material I've chosen doesn't actually have much depth to it. Like, it's a fairly flat material. So if I zoom all the way in, we can see it. Essentially references the height map to blend smoothly. I guess it kind of looks smooth, like the difference here between the mesh and the ground. That's something I like to focus on with my scenes. Like, when you get, like, two pieces of geometry that just, like, fit together, and then there's, like, a really distinct line between them, it can be super jarring. So pixel depth offset is a great way to just, like, vary up the transition between meshes.
Okay, pixel depth offset, that's what I need to look into. Okay, cool.
Yeah. It's good to reference a height map texture for that. It makes, like, some really convincing effects, but if not, you can also just plug in, like, a scalar parameter, maybe, like, multiply that by a temporal AA dither to get, like, a really smooth transition. And then that's essentially, like, a fade. You can have, like, your asset, like, opacity fade out into the landscape, so it's, like, a really smooth gradient.
Sweet.
But, yeah, that's where that came from. Why not 5 has so many amazing features, someone said in the chat. Well, I would say Unreal Engine 5 is 98% Unreal Engine 4. Like, you've got some nice features just to fit on the top, but the bulk of it is still what Unreal Engine 4 is, essentially. So you've got, like, all the same stuff.
To me, it's like, it's just cool how it automatically sets up the lighting and the bounce light and everything for you, and it just looks so beautiful. As a beginner, I've really been enjoying it and, like, getting a pretty immediate image that looks nice makes me, like, more excited to continue to, like, create in the program, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. You're talking about like Unreal Engine 5 with their like features?
Yeah, Lumen and stuff, yeah.
Yeah, that technology is so impressive. I'm not sure if I'll be able to use it for the game I'm producing, but
No, dude, you're, what you're doing now is beautiful. Like, your workflow is absolutely incredible.
Oh, thanks, man. I was going to say, like, I'd love to use, like, Lumen and stuff, but it's actually not particularly designed for masked materials. Like, my landscapes are filled with plants, right? And for plants, you have to use masked materials. And there's not a whole lot of support for that at the moment. Like, if you look at the stuff Unreal Engine is doing with Unreal 5, it's all, like, opaque meshes. You've got like the desert environment, which looks stunning, but yeah, all opaque meshes. And then this latest Matrix Awakens thing they put together is again all opaque meshes for all the buildings. So yeah, I'm wondering, like, will natural environments be at like sort of a standstill with Unreal Engine 5? I'm not too sure, but. But it's interesting. Maybe I'll still be able to use my old tricks and get by. But
I'd rather know them than not, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I try really hard to just like, yeah, it's important with any software to like, you know, spend the time learning the new features, because it's always easy to like stay in your comfort zone and stick with what you know. Hence, I haven't really picked up any other renderers aside from Unreal. It's sort of a part of my laziness, but you know,
it's all good. Yeah, man. You're really good at it. It's hard to switch to a new program. That's why I've had such a difficult time here, is like trying to figure out how to switch to a new program, and like there's so many roadblocks, there's so many hurdles to jump over. But you know, for me, I have to find the wins, the small wins along the way, and like forcing myself to complete a project was a huge win for me. Like that music video I did was a huge win, and that pushed me further to like continue learning this program. If you don't have small little wins for yourself, it makes it really hard to find the motivation to keep going.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's see.
I think I might be getting somewhere. I'm gonna have maybe like a horribly unoptimized package at the end of this, but something. Don't forget the obnoxious requirements, someone said. Yeah, I mean, you know, Unreal Engine 4, when that came out, the requirements were pretty obnoxious back then as well. Like, I was trying to run Unreal. When I started, I had, like, an AMD, like, really cheap card. I was getting, like, 30 frames a second. But, you know, that stuff changes with time. Like, soon the standard will be, like, the rate these cards are getting developed, like the standard is going to be like exponential. The cards are going to be like insane. It's just, that's my prediction, I guess.
Yeah, it's going to keep getting better and better and more accessible. That's a guarantee.
Yeah, I mean, Unreal, like they really push accessibility, like with all their features, like everything is just like, you know, drag it into the scene and it works, like. Especially with like Nanite, all of that virtualized geometry stuff, like you don't have to worry about poly counts as much.
Mm-hmm.
Super cool. And like in the future, you only have to have like a base knowledge to be able to put this stuff together. All right, I'm getting something ready here. I'm just gonna go into like some color correction. It doesn't look like we have too much time.
Yeah, I'm gonna like color correct as touches. Well.
I was meaning to mention, I guess I'll mention it quickly for those listening. Like, there are some great features with lighting that I use, like distance field ambient occlusion. If you've got distance field enabled for your shadows or for some other reason, ambient occlusion is a great, like looks so great. If I enable it real quick. Oh, it's already enabled. Yeah, it's like a...
Oh, wow.
It just, like, makes these, like, nice ambient occlusion spots where it seems like it would naturally fit. It's super handy. Yeah, that, and you've got other tricks like, you know, screen space, ambient occlusion, and I used to use these decals for my ambient occlusion when I wanted, like, some really big spots. I'll just bring it up. It's one of my tricks I keep close to my heart. Like, if I get a... AR decal material, and I put that into my decal, and then I put that in a dark spot.
Oh, so you're hand placing these, like, ambient occlusion decals?
Yeah, yeah, it's like a hand place thing. Like, it's for if you want, like, in specific areas there to be much more variation. So at the moment, can I notice that? Yeah, you can sort of see, like, there's a darkness patch wherever I drag this decal.
Yeah, absolutely.
I just enabled distance field ambient occlusion to show this off, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's smart because it doesn't affect skylight. Like, that's just because it's an ambient occlusion decal. It only affects shadows.
Mm-hmm.
And I expect this is what they use, like, when I look at some games, like GTA, for example, you've got these cars with, like, nice ambient occlusion underneath the car. It's because they've attached an ambient occlusion decal to the bottom. I think that's why. Because when you get the sun coming in under the car, there's no shadow. But then as soon as it's covered in shadow again, it's like you can see the influence of the ambient occlusion. It's a pretty cool, it's a pretty smart thing.
It's just crazy that, like, all of your games are so handmade. Like, down to placing the shadows, that's insane. That's so cool.
Yeah, I guess. I used to do the same thing, just quickly I'll mention, with lights as well. If you prop in, like, a point light, and then just turn off shadows, turn off details, then you can get, like, a convincing, like, bounce light effect for some areas. Obviously, this takes a bit of experimentation, but...
Wow.
But it can be pretty cheap as well. And if it comes up in the fog, that your specular scale to zero. Work. Maybe it's a different camera.
That totally makes sense, though. Like, zero. You set it to more of, like, a warm kind of light, and it'll bounce right off. That's so cool.
Exactly.
Wow, it's all these hacks
also,
and,
like,
cheats. That's great.
There's also keeping in mind, like, screen space global illumination, which is useful as well. It has, like, a fake GI effect. Yeah, that's just, like, it's a shame it's, like, just about, like, the end of the stream and I'm just, like, remembering about all these tricks, but...
That's all good. It's, like, as long as people can, like, if you give them the stuff that they can, like, go off, so... Screen space global illumination, right? That's another thing.
Yes. Yeah, I mean that's a pretty effective one. I think you have to choose between screen space ambient occlusion and global illumination. You can't have both enabled at once. But yeah, that's super useful. Yeah, I guess this is just like leaving little Easter eggs for those who've like watched the whole stream or the whole VOD. They'll be able to find the real tip at the very end. Matt, have you worked with big? Sorry, I'm just reading the chat now. Matt, have you worked with big maps without the engine lagging? I'm getting a bit of lag at the moment, but you just got to like adjust. One thing is adjust your landscape LODs. It doesn't have a huge influence, but it's helpful. And another one is. Yeah, just like optimization in general, like keep your poly counts low, keep your LODs like reasonably aggressive, set cull distances for objects that you can't see in the distance, so it like culls them out of your vision. Yeah, there's all sorts of stuff that can relate to that.
So how are we looking? What are there any other things that you would need to do to bake this out as a as an EXE, or you think we can export this thing?
The tips for that are essentially file package Windows, and then you just wait, and then it takes a while to like compile all the shaders, which it takes longer the first time than subsequent times, but I think, yeah, after the stream I'll just like hit that compile button, see where it gets. I mean, if I go to my first person character, which I don't know where I put it.
Yeah, that look.
And then just,
do you want to go full screen? I'll go full screen on you, and you go full screen in Unreal and go your first person and just kind of like walk around, and then that's kind of what people will be able to see when they download the EXE. There should be a link here in the description by the time you're watching this, hopefully in the next hour or so. But you it's 4 a.m. so for you, so we'll figure
honestly,
that out.
Honestly, I'm feeling fine. Like I've been building up to this a little bit. I had my coffee. You know, I've been coughing off stream. But yeah, so at the moment I just put in my first person template, and essentially gives me like, you know, WASD controls. I can walk around. I have a camera. I can bring that up. I can zoom in on stuff. Take some photos. I might zoom in on a tree, just to see what we're working with. Focus in. Yeah, we've got some nice details.
So cool.
Actually, it's cool because this template also has a bunch of optimizations that I put in all my game settings. So if I like put my quality all the way down, I'll be able to get some of our frames back somewhat. Maggie. Alright, I'm just gonna get stuck into my like, do we have a specific like limit on the stream? Like, do you reckon? I'm happy to work just a little bit longer to get something that looks really good.
I can. So here's what I need to do. I need to move my car real quick. That's gonna take 30 seconds. I need to come back here and announce the winners of the weekly challenge. I can do that while you work. That might take 15 minutes or 20 minutes. I'll go through some honorable mentions, and then to wrap the stream out, we'll come back and see what your scene looks like, and then we can call it.
Yeah, that sounds good to me. I'd be happy to look at weekly winners as well, though. I was excited to see like what people have done.
Cool. Yeah. Let me run to move my car real quick. Are you good to be? I'll just leave you here with the audience doing your thing.
Yeah, I'll
be back in like a minute and a half. And then we'll get into those weekly winners. Good times. See you in a second.
Yeah, sounds good. All right, Kyan, he said he was from West Australia. He said almost 4 a.m. here. And yeah, that's where I am as well. It's 3:30. I think we got the same time zone. What's in the decal? I'll just check quickly. Simple. I made it a while ago. It is it got like a radial gradient. So if you plug in a density into the radial gradient, it just effectively has a circular drop-off for the ambient occlusion. And I found that was a good way. Instead of having any half edges, like harsh edges on the edge of the decal, it just gets like a nice, sort of like a paintbrush type thing you can place around. And I've just got like a strength, just do a bit of math, and then yeah, it's like super simple. I'm tempted to just like go full focus mode, but I feel bad ignoring the chat, so I'm just gonna check in every once in a while. Making a game? Kinda, yeah. I'm making a scene which I can use as a game if I'd like to. Obviously not everything is in very good shape at the moment, and we're not optimized terribly well, but yeah, the goal is to prop this first person template in and then export an EXE file, and then people will be able to download it and just walk around. Yeah, that was the goal. I use assets or make it myself. I almost completely source my assets. So there's a whole bunch of stuff available, like mega scans, the Unreal Marketplace. I just like download in bulk. My library is huge. I just got back from trekking Mardi Himal. Surprised to see this. That's crazy. I would love to do that trek. I saw that video and yeah, it's on my bucket list for sure. Looks stunning. Never been to Nepal. And sorry, I'm not really focusing. I'm just gonna. What was I gonna do? Bloggers. It's awesome to be here, man. It's so cool to like interact with you guys. What GPU? I've only got a mobile 2060, so I'm running this off a laptop right now. And it's sort of all I've got to work with at the moment, but with the stuff I'm doing, like, you know, I can push decent frames, like I don't have too many issues. The reason my shadows have turned like super black, I'm really confused as to why that's happening. Values maybe. Oblivion? I've not played Oblivion, but yeah, I guess this reminds me of Skyrim in a way, so there you go. Man, it's super hard to work at the same time. Maybe I'll just like read the chat.
Yo.
Yo.
How you looking?
Looking good. I've run into a problem with my shadow. Ambient occlusion detail. No. I might just give my project a quick restart. So yeah, just to see if that fixes the problems with the
Sounds
shadows.
Good.
Yeah, I'm just hanging out with the chat, having a good time.
Sweet. I think it's time to review some weekly art. How does that sound?
Yeah, for sure. That sounds great.
Sweet. Awesome. Okay. So every single week on the Discord, the link is in the description, we do a weekly challenge, and the prompt this week was upside down. So I'm going to review the upside down winners, reveal the five winners. If you win, you unlock the entire Discord server. It's a full server full of a bunch of artists who are, you know, trying to help each other out and share their work and get advice and give advice. It's a nice place to go for that kind of stuff. And outside of the five winners, we're going to talk about the honorable mentions as well. So let's jump into it here. All right. So like I mentioned, upside down is the prompt for this week. So the first winner of the weekly challenge this week is Soulnate with this super cool Time magazine cover. Definitely reminds me of the Spider-Man, the Spider-Verse like scene where he drops down into the city. It's like the same body position, but I just love the way that you took that and you moved it to a different kind of setup. I think this is really, really cool. I don't know how you're gonna get that little biplane, that little Cessna in space, but hey, you know, you pulled it off. It's freaking sweet. Matt, can you see this art, by the way?
Yeah, I was just figuring out. I just had to open the stream on Discord, but yeah, that's good now. Yeah, man.
This is pretty sweet.
Yeah, it looks iconic. It looks like a, Yeah, they could use that as a color for sure.
I feel like the only thing I would say is like you're cut. I just realized too, you're cutting off time. You're cutting off the bottom text, and I would maybe I would.
I'm cool with that. I love how the plane's upside down.
Yeah, exactly. That's the whole point, right? The prompt was upside down, so they're doing it in a pretty sweet way. Soul Nate's a
Oh,
great artist. Puts out really cool stuff. Next up, Sotomonte, working behind the scenes. Do you mind just hiding the art for me while I bring up the next stuff? Thank you so much, sir. Next up, we have one dead duck with this pretty brutal scene here. It'd be a rough scene to come across, especially in one of your games, Matt. That'd be quite the sight. Do you put Easter eggs in your games by chance? Like, do you slip stuff in?
I have done some stuff, but like nothing in the vein of like horror or anything horrifying. Like I wanna build trust with people playing my games. I'm not gonna chuck in like a jump scare anywhere.
No, that'd
But
be
people have
rough.
asked me about it. Yeah, people have asked me about it, but no, I'm like straying away from that stuff. Yeah.
That's good. That's good. What about sentimental items? Do you put sentimental items like you sneak those around your scenes?
Oh yeah, that's one of the mechanics. Like there are a bunch of collectibles around, and the object changes depending on which environment it is. Yeah.
That's cool. Heck yeah.
Anyway, yeah, this I love like the atmospherics. Like you can never hate like having like a good foggy background. And I love like the color correction done on it as well.
Yes, absolutely. One Dead Duck puts out solid work, wins these weekly challenges quite often, and I believe this is made in Unreal Engine. I think Unreal 5, I'm pretty sure. He just started getting into it, so he's doing a really nice job. So congrats, One Dead Duck. You get the challenge winner roll this week. Who do we got next? Coming up. In number three, Sotomonte, why don't you just hide it right off the back because they're gonna double stack here. But number three, we got JCKB with this beautiful scene. I'm a huge fan of The Last of Us, and there's a scene in The Last of Us 2 where you go on this village and it's lit like this, it looks like this, but you added this like UFO in here as well. Like, it's so well done. It's so well lit. I love your colors and everything. It's awesome.
Yeah, sorry, I can only see like a small version of it, but yeah, like those reds and blues. I always love like those that color scheme, no matter what the
Yeah.
subject matter is. So
Yeah,
it's
it
awesome.
looks great. I love that lighting so much. Such a big fan of that style. So JC, KB, congratulations. You got the challenge winner roll this week. Keep it up. I think this might be your second or third win, so congratulations to you. Up next, in no specific order, all right, but this is the fourth one here. Jack the Hack. I love this so much. It feels like a Wolfenstein game or something. But you got this character running on the top of this mental asylum. I assume it's a mental patient. It looks like some crazy testing going on or something, or like it's all jacked up. I wonder where they got that sword from. It's a pretty cool looking sword. I just have so many questions about this scene, but I love your color. I love your composition. I love the framing and the atmospherics you have in this. I think it's super cool. So, congratulations, Jack the
Yeah,
Hack.
super nice work. It reminds me of I used to play a bunch of Battlefield 1 and those look like World War 1 like outfits.
It's
Yeah,
really hard to
respect.
tell, but it's like he's got that trench coat vibe to it, and the guns, like, they look like sticks almost. I don't know
Some
if.
experts probably waiting, ready to like bone us on that, but
It's the boots and the long coats, but
yeah.
they actually don't look like guns from this view. Maybe they are, though. But anyway, Jack the Hack, congratulations. Very good stuff. And finally, we have our very own visual killing it with this. Like, dude, your render quality is insane. This is
Yeah,
basically,
that is nuts.
yeah, that's like a picture. It's like a really well lit picture. That's insane how good this is. Your character work and your render quality is off the charts, man. Absolutely.
Put that incredible. In the genre of like zoom, like look really closely and squint to see if you can tell if it's a render or not. That's the that would be the category.
Yes, exactly. That's what I strive for with all my renders. And you are killing it right now, visual. So congratulations. Since you're already, you're a moderator, right? Mods can win this thing. It just comes down to the art. You got the good art. Are you going to win this or not? But since you already have full unlock of the server, you got your challenge winner role ready to be passed off to one of our honorable mentions. And I don't know if he's first up, but I will definitely get there when it comes along. So Sotomonte, working behind the scenes right now. If you could just work from the top down on honorable mentions and just tell me who it is and I'll get into it. All right, we got Lil Child Support as the first honorable mention. I dig this so much. Like, I love your silhouette, I love your colors, and I love your framing, and I think this just looks awesome. So you should please keep it up. I've seen you on the server doing some awesome stuff. Keep doing your thing. This looks fantastic. Yeah, your colors and your silhouettes are great. I love working with silhouettes. It's the best. So good. Honorable mention number two. We got Dre G up next, I believe. Yeah, this is awesome. I love your colors here. I love your composition. Your framing is super solid. You came very close. You came very close to winning this one. If I had to give any advice or any, like, any pointers, maybe, I don't know, maybe move some of the asteroids below the astronaut as well. And maybe take the two out that are behind his arm, by his fingers and his arm, and move them down below the actual astronaut.
I love the harsh space light coming in, like the strong shadows. Looks pretty crisp.
Yeah, the space lighting is a really hard vibe to nail, and you did a really good job here. So, Dre G, congrats for that honorable mention. Keep it up, doing good stuff. Next up, we have, who do we got? 007 is next up for honorable mention. I love your composition. I love this idea so much. It's such a cool idea. Your lighting even is fantastic. Like, this is super solid. I feel like you can probably get some crown molding up there between the wall and the ceiling. And I'm having trouble deciding like what that is on the window on the right. Is that the moon? Is that outside? It's a little hard to tell, but overall, I really dig this. What do you think, Matt?
Yeah, it's like super, super interesting. I personally, like, I would have to rack my brain to come up with that kind of concept. I think that's really cool.
Yeah, it's super sick. Really good stuff. 007. Keep it up. Next up, we have PixWin. For honorable mention, you came darn close. Very similar vibe. I just love your colors, love your composition, and I love your lighting. So I wanted to give you a shout out. I thought this was super cool. Keep up the good work. Very good stuff. And finally, we have the Game Factory for honorable mention. And Visual is going to pass his weekly challenge winner role off to you. He liked yours the most. And this is just a cool little video here. At this point, I'm like, wait, what? How do these two places, like, what is going on? Okay. It's a little space setup. And they have a very intricate diorama of
that must have taken so long.
That's awesome. That's cool. The Game Factory, very good stuff. I dig it. Congratulations to all the challenge winners: Soul Nate, One Dead Duck, JC, KB, Jack the Hack, and Visual. Y'all are doing great stuff. So you got the challenge winner role, and the Game Factory, of course. Very awesome. Matt, we're nearing the end here. We're at the end of this stream. Did you wanna?
Sounds like it.
Do touch on any last little things before we wrap it up?
I mean, I'm not too sure. I think, I wanted to mention that I'll be putting out an EXE of this project that I did. Obviously the cracks are there, like I threw it together. I'm excited for people to watch the VOD and then maybe try it out if you were to leave the link in the description. I think that's a cool way. Like seeing the software, downloading it and like exploring yourself. It's like definitely heightens the experience. Like it definitely changes everything. So I'm super excited for you guys to try it out.
You also unlocked download of your latest game, right? That's also in the description.
Yeah. I think I'll leave that enabled for quite a while. So I'll leave it up for like the next week or so. It's like a beta for the game that I'm working on at the moment, which is. The entire game is a compilation of environments that you're able to explore and take photos in. But the beta is just one environment. It's an environment inspired by the Italian Alps. So if you have a PC rig that you can try it out on, you don't necessarily need a high-end graphics card. I think 1060 is like the minimum recommended spec. So,
sweet.
Try it out. Let me know your thoughts. I have a Discord and stuff. I'm just trying to build something that hopefully everyone will... we'll get behind. I really appreciate the chance to like show off the stuff that I'm doing and like what I'm working towards. I'm super lucky. I really appreciate it,
dude. Absolutely. And we're gonna be in touch and we're gonna keep hanging out and learning together, and I can't wait to learn more from you, and I can't wait to see this game when it finally drops the full deal. But like, seriously, if y'all want to dive into the maxed out version of what we just did on the stream, click the link to Cave's website. It's in the description below. Go there, scroll down a little bit. You can download the game, the beta, for this certain level and hop in and see it for yourself. It's unbelievable. It's so cool. So dude, thank you so much for joining me. Thanks for doing this together. Like, thanks for your patience. Have a freaking great holiday. Have a take a break, chill out, and enjoy yourself, man.
Thanks, man. I had such a great time, man. Like, having like tons of people watching, interacting with people in the chat. Yeah, it's been so great.
Heck yeah, dude.
Sweet. I hope you guys enjoy. Yeah, if you guys, it'd be winter at the moment for us. I'm starting to heat up. Got some warm summer days ahead.
That's so crazy. Yeah, it's so hard to comprehend.
I don't prefer summer for like doing work and working on environments, but you know, maybe I'll have to take a trip up to the Northern Hemisphere for a bit.
Please do. Please come visit Los Angeles. All right.
I'd love to someday.
Yeah, man. We'll friggin' do it. We'll hang out and we'll go on a hike or something. We'll do something awesome.
Oh, hell yeah. Hell yeah.
All right, man. Good times. Peace out. Thank you all for joining us.
Yeah, GG. See you soon. Thanks, everybody.
Later.